That's how he does his prep.
Yep, it's true.
Five Koreans, therefore they will win. But you're wrong, Monte Cristo. 3-1 for Fnatic. Easy peasy.
We won. Well, according to my analysts, it's going to be 3-1 either way, but tipped in favor of Fnatic, the hometown favorites here. As we hand it off to our casters for the call, we'll take a closer look at how two friends are about to reunite on the world stage. But only one will walk away a world finalist.
We were like joking each other, like next year let's meet at world, let's meet at the final, let's meet at the semifinal, like this, you know. But it actually happened.
원래 IM 팀에 같이 있었어요. IM 1팀, 2팀 있었는데 서로 처음엔 다른 팀이었다가 이제 같은 팀이 되었는데 서로 진짜 못했던 것 같아요. 그냥 항상 탑을 하면서 제가 솔직히 욕도 많이 먹고 그랬거든요. 성적도 잘 안 나오고.
The team kind of like needed like tanky champions, and then the meta was like pretty much like tanky champions, but he was actually good at like damage champion, like he enjoyed playing it, but the power was that he cannot like play as same as solo queue and competitive. He didn't have confidence because he's losing a lot of games, and even me, I think I was like losing so much confidence by losing the game.
레이너브 선수는 저는 항상 잘하는 정글러라고 생각했어요. 이 정도까지 잘하는 정글러라고 생각했는데 좀 이상하게 대회만 가면은 막 이렇게 던지는 플레이도 많이 나오고 그러더라고요.
Like, at that time I was like playing like, really bad. I have a bad nickname which people like calls me like the game over, you know. This kind of nicknames make me like more like improve, you know, eager to improve and then like try hard to recover. So I just try to improve myself. And then try to not be the game over.
저는 솔직히 쿠 들어오기 전에도 이제 같이 어디서든 같이 하기로 얘기를 했었거든요.
Me and Smap decided to go out from the IM, and when we were like looking for the team, like we were looking for the team together, you know. We practiced together so long time, and then like even until the last time that Smap decided to go KOO and I decided to go Fnatic, we were really trying to go to the team together as a top jungle.
각자 다른 팀으로 가게 됐는데 저도 이제 KOO 와서 배우고 그 친구도 이제 Fnatic 가서 많이 배웠다고 하더라고요. 그런 던지는 플레이를 좀 팀원들이 잘 잡아준다고 하더라고요. 그래서 좀 많이 달라진 것 같아요.
Like we actually throw each other, like even from like the group stage.
원래 제가 좀 레이노브 선수를 많이 놀리곤 했었어요. 그 IM에 있을 때도. 그래서 그 예선전 1주차가 끝나고 저희는 2승 1패고 Fnatic은 1승 2패였단 말이에요. 그래서 제가 식당에 앉아 있는데 Fnatic이 거기 가서 여기 1승 2패는 앉으면 안 된다고. 저기 볼게, 나 공원에서 먹어야 된다고 밥을 그렇게 얘기했었어요.
When we finish our seat with the first group, first seat, and then they finish our second seat, and then it's my turn to throw him like, oh, you cannot enter this hotel because obviously this hotel is for first seat, you know. So like we're trolling each other. So I cannot imagine how much criticism I can take from Smeb when they lose the game. So we're just like really want to win each other.
네, 한국에 올 때마다 놀려주려고요. 네, 꼭 놀려주고 싶어요. 이겨서.
Hello everybody, we're gonna find out who will be able to pick on whom as this best of five plays out. I'm Trevor Quickshot Henry, joined by Joshua Jatt Leesman and Martin Moose on the loose, Deficio Lunga. We're gonna jump into this best of five shortly. The players have still got a couple of minutes before we start picks and bans. Yeah. So let's talk about the transition both of these teams have faced. Fnatic going 3-0 against EDG in quite a dramatic series, and then KOO Tigers turning around their, you know, early game dominance of groups into mid to late game control against KT Rolster Jets.
Yeah, and interestingly enough, Smeb trolled Reignover by saying 1-2 after the first week, and that was the last time Fnatic lost a game. So they've been on a 6-game winning streak since then. I think their champion select has picked up, and they've been able to make some very bold calls within the game. Everyone follows incredibly well, And that has been kind of the catalyst to allow Fnatic go on this 6-0 run.
Yeah, and Fnatic is a team who always talks about how they need time to prepare. Once they can set up the right pick and ban phase, they know how to play in-game. So they had that extra week in the group stages where now they played the teams. They knew what they could expect. Same for EDG, and now they had another week here for KOO Tigers. But I do think KOO Tigers also is a team who does really well in best out of fives because they can use the time to prepare proper strategies. Monty talked about how to have some crazy picks from time to time. That can surprise Fnatic. Mm-hmm.
And really, we have to talk about the difference between the KOO Tigers in the group stages and the KOO Tigers we saw in the quarterfinals. They were so reactive to what KD did in the quarterfinals. They had very poor ward coverage within the river. They put almost all their wards at their own buffs, red and blue, and then took gold deficits into the mid-game,
yeah.
Then won team fights when KT tried to engage. So that actually sets up a lot of conflict because that's what Fnatic does all the time.
Yeah, but Jet, this is how KOO have played. Monty has reminded us every opportunity that KOO can play from behind. KT Rollster couldn't close the game out. Is Fnatic going to be able to do it?
I'm going to say yes, because I think KT Rollster had horrible shot calling in that game, and they got too many leads in the early game that they should have been able to use to win the games.
Yeah. I'm going to say if KOO Tigers doesn't ward the river and it only puts up defensive wards, that is a recipe for defeat.
So let's find out how the warding and the decision-making will play out. Tom Kench is on the bench. Fnatic may have learned their lesson.
Yeah, Shen Ban as well. Gorilla played it, obviously, earlier in the quarterfinals. We've seen it from Yellowstar. And KOO Tigers, as a team, in 7 out of 10 games here at Worlds, they've banned Mordekaiser and Lulu. So even on blue side, they're very often banned the Mordekaiser, so no surprise so far. They stick to what we consider the OPs in Mordekaiser and Gangplank.
Yeah, now we have to track the power picks. Elise is probably the final one. There
Rek'Sai
it goes.
First pick.
And Rek'Sai means the first pick. Honestly, from the last quarterfinals, I didn't see that much value in the Rek'Sai first pick.
So the risk always for these teams with the Rek'Sai first pick is obviously what is the gap between Rek'Sai and the next best jungler? In this sense, like, Lee Sin is not a great matchup into Rek'Sai, but a confident player might take it anyway and just dodge around the Rek'Sai and you can still have a very active early game. KOO Tigers get two very, very good picks, especially Alistar, I think is a key takeaway from Yellowstar, because Yellowstar uses him to have the safe lane. Always just sit back, you can't really dive the Alistar, you can always heal up his AD carry, and Fnatic has that 2v2 lane with zero jungle help. KOO Tigers steal that away and get a very strong 2v2 lane.
Now, with that being said, I do like Rainover on Rek'Sai, so not being able to give it over Hojin. I feel like Hojin will now go with Lee Sin, even though it's not a great matchup. Also, the analyst has touched on the Ashe versus Kennen trades that could be happening in this series. Well, if you're going to leave Kalista up, Prey is just going to take that. Maybe we end up seeing the Kennen or the Ashe from Reckless if they take away their picks.
I would almost prefer Ashe here. I think Ashe is really good into Kalista for the laning phase itself. And now that we have two dual lanes, doesn't get much help. Having a stronger one can be very, very important. Okay.
And gentlemen,
we're going back in time a little bit.
Is this
going
to be support Nautilus here? We know Huni's not a predominant tank player. And looking at how Yellowstar's champion pool's been hit, not only with the bans, but also of that Alistar, I almost feel like that's the direction it's going
to
go.
Definitely going to expect it to be support for him. Kalista is one of these AD carries. If you do manage to lock her down, obviously she's very easy to kill. If she gets to kite back, she becomes a problem. Nautilus ulti says you're not going anywhere. At some point it will hit her. And then Fnatic, if they have more champions who can dive the backline, which we often see from Huni, that's a good way to set up a way to kill the AD carry.
It is a throwback to when Kalista was first kind of on the competitive scene. Take as many champions as possible that can press one button on Kalista and stop her from hopping around so damn much.
The thing is still, the 2v2 lane for Fnatic with this Kennen.
Whoa!
I'm not a fan of it. Okay.
Jungle Ladies Zach. And gentlemen, we have two new champions. Zach has been locked in. Kobe was making jokes about the engage potential on his elastic slingshot.
Well,
DeFisher, you're shaking your head.
It's been buffed since Azingi was so dominant with it in the North American LCS, DeFisher.
I was sitting down and having a nice dinner with Kobe. And obviously, as always, we talk about the game.
We talked
about Zach.
We were tracking Hojin solo queue as well. There were Jungle Zach games.
5 days ago.
There were Jungle Zach games on the solo queue accounts of the KOO Tigers.
But the thing about this pick here now, early game, it's obviously not the greatest. His Raptor camp, like max rank E, and he would just fly into the mid lane.
Yeah, as far as Zach's best lane to gank, it actually is mid lane because it violates the standard wards you would see in that mid lane. This is what Huni picked into Riven, game 1 of Worlds, into IG, and he smashed with it. So this is his considered counterpick against the Riven.
Yeah, and the reason he picked it was because on Hecarim, you can rush Frozen Heart early on. Riven doesn't really have any kill pressure on you once that item is completed, and you start playing around team fights and flanking instead with Hecarim. So look here what Fnatic has been building. Nautilus is going to activate his ulti onto the Kalista, then Hecarim is going to fly in from the flank. That's two guys that will smack down Kalista. Very, very effective. And Ku Tigers, they don't care about wave play apparently in this game.
If Ku fall behind, they are in so much trouble.
Well, this is what you would call, what probably would call a fight comp. What Korean caster Cloud Champlain would call that, I think, sword?
Spear comp.
Spear comp, sorry. I messed that one up. But it is absolutely, if Fnatic tries to siege, they die. But then you look at Fnatic, they actually don't want to siege
it's
much
a fight
either.
Comp as well.
Both of these guys are going to be clashing into each other. This is not your wave clear game.
We're going to have a ton of team fights. And I think about Febiman, he often doesn't take teleport in the mid lane. So against the Kassadin, he's looking to have more kill pressure in the lane, 1v1, but he will sacrifice the later stages of the game when it comes to 1v1ing as a Kassadin with teleport. So Fnatic is often down one global summoner. And if Ku Tigers can get towards that late game, that can be very key with this Kassadin.
And this early game is going to be so important for both teams. If you can get ahead with a spear comp, and stay ahead through fights,
you can
that's how you close
effect.
This out. So for Rainover on this Rek'Sai, gonna have some work cut out for him if he wants to go up and give either Huni or Febiven some advantage, which is what we've seen time and time again from Fnatic and Rainover's pathing.
Yeah, this champ select as well, I feel like, was pretty heavy on the counter picks. Huni thinks Hecarim is a counter to Riven, and Kassadin actually is very good against the Blanc, one of the champions that can actually beat him, her in lane, rather.
And we're going to need to see how Kuro is going to handle it. Kassadin is locked in. Zach is locked in for the first time at the 2015 League of Legends World Championship. Guys, you know the deal. Jump on Twitter and vote for who you think will advance to Berlin for the chance to battle SKT. Hashtag Fnatic win or hashtag KOO win. 74 unique champions now as the games continue to play out, and as the analyst desk predicted, it's Hojin with the weird and wonderful jungle pick.
Well, even if we think back to the last World Championship, something about the finals brings out weird jungler picks. Insect played Fiddlesticks and Pantheon last year in the semifinals.
he had some special picks for sure, but this obviously is also because Gragas has been removed, so that pool of junglers is now wide open for who is the third best jungler after Rek'Sai and Elise. And you can very often bait that first pick, so KOO definitely knew what they were doing. When they said, you're going to get Rek'Sai, it's perfectly fine. We're not looking to fight you early on anyway, but a Kassadin pre-level 6 against a LeBlanc here with an offensive summoner and a Rek'Sai. Yeah. Fnatic can go towards that mid lane very easily.
Speaking about that mid lane, Kuro will be pushed in, and also Zac is a low pressure early game jungler if his first gank doesn't work. So Zac's level 3 or level 4 gank is actually pretty potent, but after that he gets fairly weak. It will be about Hojin's first gank and whether or not Febiven and Rainover take the aggressive paths into the jungle of KOO.
And technically speaking, statistically, throughout the course of the tournament, Fnatic have been the gods of first blood. All 9 of their games, they've been able to secure that. And it has been either Febiven or Huni that's been involved.
Yeah, there's been some help with that as well. The one game they didn't get first blood was remade.
It was
Kragas bug. So it still counts 100%.
Officially, anyway.
Officially 100%.
Yep, that's the best kind of correct. But
yes.
No funny business as far as lanes are concerned. It does look like Praying Gorilla are near top. So lane swap initiated by KOO.
I mean, we have to see with KOO Tigers. We mentioned how in the group stages, they were super aggressive, making so many plays early on. And then against KT, they were sitting back. Kills at 20 minutes in group stage for KOO Tigers over 6 games were 51. 4 games against KT in the quarterfinals at 20 minutes, they had 12 kills. They got only 5 towers as well in all 4 games. They were sitting so far back enough, you can't do that here because then Fnatic will invade into your jungle, find that Zac and pressure you too much.
Well, this is going to be really tricky for KOO Tigers because Kassadin and Zac don't have too much early game presence. How will Gorilla roam around? How will that work against the Nautilus? And specifically, I think the most important matchup right now, since they are both melees in the top lane that will eventually face each other, is Smeb or Huni. Which one will get the favorable lane swap?
Interesting start to the swap. Both
it's completely
teams, both teams are starting in their own jungle with their top laner. getting the camps, getting the blue buff. So there's nothing really now to take for the enemy once they go to that side of the map. Normally we divide it up, but they've been able to farm on the normal sides.
I specifically like this because these are very competent turret diving team compositions on both sides. So if you were hoping to babysit one of these top laners under a turret, you're either going to completely deny yourself a farm or get killed. So therefore, doing an extended double jungle is favorable.
So Fnatic hard push in the bottom lane to try and reset the wave and get it back here for Huni once he returns to this, or once he goes down to this bottom side, and then swap up top lane. But KOO Tigers is reading that situation because they didn't see anyone on the bottom side once the wave hit the tower. So they know, okay, Fnatic is recalling. Why? Because they want to swap top. We do not want a 2v2 them right now, apparently. So we're going to try and swap back to the bottom side. Seems like they're making...
change their mind.
A little change for them.
So who won that trade, actually? Because Huni didn't hit level 3, but Smeb did from the jungle as well as catching that wave. So Smeb has about a third of a level experience advantage early on.
Rainova has already found Kuro. Their event's going to connect with the chains and get a good amount of damage down. That will give some control to Febevent, but still sustain on the side of Kuro.
Well, it's what we talked about, how Fnatic can look to try and gank this mid lane early on. Didn't get a flash roll. Kuro stood very, very far back. But Huni, he's not necessarily looking to outtrade Smeb. He wants to just try and farm up as much as possible, get that first armor item under his belt, and then he's going to be safe enough and start making plays with his team. He's not going to get that same lead he got in the week one where he played this matchup and he was like so far ahead just from the lane swap.
Never spending quite a bit of time in this mid lane. Get to lead after that gank earlier. And Huni going to get caught by all three procs of the Broken Wings. Trying to sustain as best he can and get some damage back with advantage Smeb.
Keep in mind, Smeb went back to base as well, so he has a long sword where Huni's still sitting on Flask.
And as long as Huni doesn't die before he goes back to base, he can come back with an advantage. I think Huni's waiting to buy multiple items, then we'll teleport in. So I actually expect Smeb and Huni to have different teleport timers, and that will actually lead to different power spikes within that lane.
Reno is back in the mid lane, though. He should know there's so many wards. He normally doesn't care about wards at all. He just ignores it and goes for the gank anyway. And that opens up for a guy like Hojin, who's very good at counter ganking, to try and respond if they go too aggressive on Koro.
Yeah, but we also have to remember, it's a one-level disadvantage, and it's a Zac. If he doesn't land his elastics in time, he's got nothing. 33 CS to 16, not the best time to be spamming your flare.
I mean, this is so annoying for Koro because, yes, he can see the enemy jungler and he won't die to it, but it still stops him from getting any farm because he has to sit so far back whenever Reynova shows himself near the mid lane. Febevent is running Flask, so he can't sustain from this, but not the greatest trade ever from him.
No, we did see him threading the needle on LeBlanc earlier in the tournament, dodging those tower shots, but didn't manage to pull it off this time, and Reynova's going to steal that Gromp away. A little bit of a threat to dive, but no onslaught of shadows, and Flash was up for Smeb, so risky business.
So far this early game is playing to the tendencies of the teams, as well as the players, as well as the champions. So much is as expected. Rainover loves to be in the enemy jungler. Rek'Sai is also a great counter jungler because of Tremor Sense, and Zac has to be very passive in his own jungle early, as well as Hojin, statistically, has spent most of his time in his own jungle, whereas Rainover has spent more time in the enemy jungler than anyone else early on in the game.
It's paid off for Fnatic so far. Riptide comes out from Yellowstar. Good stun onto Gorilla. Pulverize comes down, but Yellowstar and Gorilla both leaving with most of their HP bars gone. Yellowstar's running Ignite, Febevin's Ignite, Huni's Ignite. Fnatic want to send a signal, they're looking for kills.
Very much looking to try and get something going in the early game, but the thing also about these two teams, a lot of them talk about Yellowstar and Gorilla as roaming supports, and they are outside of the laning phase. Very often they will sit together with that AD carry and lane and try and get an advantage. Hojin is going in.
Well, flash. Respect. Dredgeline to re-engage. Yellowstar's got the Titan's Wrath shield. That's not going to miss any of his HP, so they come away losing a flash and heal.
Yeah, I really have to praise Yellowstar's reaction time. As soon as he saw Zac over the wall, he instantly flashed, and that really goes to show how little respect you have for Zac after he's used his elastic slingshot, because Yellowstar very freely went back in. All of the damage as well as the mobility of Zac early game is channeled into that one spell.
Yeah, it's the one you max early on, so you barely any ranks in anything else, and your ulti, it's okay, but it's not the greatest damage either. It's gonna be a big team fighting monster on this Zac, but his team has to avoid falling behind. They're down 1,000 gold already at 7 minutes because mid lane is being won by Fnatic. Bottom lane is being won by Fnatic. We have the early Frozen Heart that Huni is building towards. We talked about how he can now safely sit and just always push out this wave and then start roaming around. into the enemy jungle, look for that Zac who can't really challenge you, and keep that pressure going.
And a big CS difference as well between Reignover and Hojin. Hojin needs to get to 6 to add to that ganking presence. He's got the lowest CSD of all junglers in the quarterfinal, or the bracket stage, rather. But naturally, the matchup, the weakness of the early game on Zac is all playing into that disparity.
This is very similar to the performance we saw out of KOO in the bracket stage.
Oh, the dredge line finds Prey. Headbutt will knock Reckless away. 200 HP, summoner heal used. Prey's going to be able to stay alive, but they get the engage and the summoner's back.
And one thing about these Kennen lanes, when you have a support with him that adds CC, it becomes so easy for you to trade when you have that mark ready, to get the first mark on the target, to quickly proc it and get the stun. Because you can see how they're timing it. Reckless says, I have 5 stacks, I'm ready. Yellow Star goes aggressive, hooks the guy in, you land the first auto attack, you then proc the whole thing, you stun him, and you win the 2v2 trade very easily.
Fnatic is demolishing KOO right now in map pressure. The top lane was safe because they didn't think Hogan was going to be ganking back. They got some very favorable trades. They also hit level 6 before the Kalista and the Alistar. Hojin's still not level 6. Reignover has been stealing his jungle. Literally every lane is going favorable for Fnatic right now.
Let's remember that KOO Tigers recalled from topside with the 2v2 lane and said, we're going to go bot lane. Then they're like, no, wait, we will go top and take the 2v2 lane. They've been losing that 2v2 lane. They lost that tower. They're not winning 1-on-1 bot lane either. They haven't managed to do anything in the early game. And they could even decide which lanes they wanted to take, or if they wanted to keep the lane swap going to try and maybe avoid some of these risky lanes.
And this will be the answer to our question of whether KOO sitting back with defensive wards can lead to victory against all these teams that are in SKT, because it worked against KT Rollster technically, because they did win the series thanks to some poor decisions and good team fighting from KOO. Kassadin, if Curl gets the item build going 3 or 4 items, is a better champion than LeBlanc at that stage in the game. Kassadin can just go at LeBlanc and kill her, but they're so far behind here and have no presence within their own jungle.
Oh, the gods of First Blood wish to decree Smip, the sacrificial top laner, to reign over Anhuni.
That is naturally what's going to happen. Smip goes up to the turret without good defensive wards, no turret behind him, and that's exactly when Reignover is going to be there. Whether or not there are wards there, that is the play Reignover should make 90 times out of 100. And Smeb didn't even see it coming, which is perplexing to say the least.
Again, it's also this Hecarim pick who can run Ignite in the lane, so he's very strong in the 1-on-1s and the 2v2. So Reignover, even if Hojin is there to counter gank him, he doesn't care. You have no damage on the Zac, you have no power here. He's gonna win that 2v2, and then suddenly Fnatic can use that to snowball Smeb right now, and the rest of KOO Tigers, they need to step up their game. Otherwise, they will fall even further behind.
It's a 1,500 gold difference, and that Frozen Heart's completed. Gentlemen, Fnatic like to teleport bottom, and they have it available. It's already being channeled from Huni. Yellowstar may get dropped low as Hojin gets knocked up in the air. First kill for KOO. Now Huni's looking to get one back. The Slicing Maelstrom will not be enough. Double kill for Smeb's Riven. Onslaught of Shadow splits everyone from KOO away.
Coming.
2 for 1. Feathervin wants to clean up. It's a triple for Smeb. Will he get more? That's 1 for Feathervin. He's got the shutdown. Turns on to Prey as Reignover finds him more.
It was an absolute bloodbath right there. 4 for 3. But the big thing we have to pay attention to is the kill distribution. Reignover got 4 of those kills, but Smeb got 3.
So KOO Tigers at least get kills on the right target. But Fnatic, they were the ones reacting first with teleport for both teams. They come down here, Hojin pulls off a gank on the bottom side. No flash from Yellowstar, so he's returning to the lane. And we can see how everyone now is trying to move. But because Fippermen is not running teleport,
yes,
he has to move all the way down the river, so he joins extremely late, and that's why KOO Tigers can get at least 3 kills on Smeb. Very important for them if they can start winning that 1v1.
Huni landed a really huge ultimate there because he didn't actually have to use that when they killed Smeb. And I do have to credit KOO here for the way they retreated through the tribe rush. Otherwise, Febben gets every single one of these kills. I thought Febben was going to get a triple kill here, and it's actually really unfortunate for Fnatic that LeBlanc didn't get those early kills, and instead they went on to Reignover. Reignover will be a nearly unkillable tank for this game, but against Kalista, eventually Kalista can kill.
Right now, almost every single flash is down after that massive fight in the bottom end. Yellowstar has his ready, didn't have it for the fight. Hojin as well didn't get to use it at all. So the following minutes, because Fnatic is having the map control, because Fnatic is dictating the laning phase, they should be able to use the fact that KOO is out of flashes. to force fights. Use Reignover again. He's level 9 to level 7 of Hojin. 29, he's 30 now for Hojin only. He's getting nothing. Reignover needs to keep being aggressive.
And he needs to keep up his efficiency and go pretty much wherever he wants. He currently has a 2,150 gold lead against Hojin. At 12 and a half minutes, he is as far ahead as any jungler has been ahead so far at Worlds here. But at the same time, Huni was pushing up top, so Foo Tigers might get a free dragon. Will Fnatic contest with a numbers disadvantage?
There's no teleport for Huni. Dragon's going low.
They want to.
1,000 HP. KOO look to secure this. They've got Ren stacks and Smite. They will take it out with the Ren. Kuro's jumped onto Yellow Star. Dredge line is used. Fnatic have split up the fight. Here comes Huni. Onslaught is available. He throws it in, but it's not good enough. KOO have got two. LeBlanc will find one back as Febivin's trying to clean up. He's looking for Zac. Hojin's cell division will not be available. This is another messy fight. It's these spear comps going head to head. Huni is tanky enough for days. He's rampaging and running down the KOO Tigers. Gorilla is in trouble. 100 hit points. Rampage and one more is all that's needed. Huni's gonna stand for the top. Gorilla, he boots them away with the headbutt. Febivin is still chasing. Low on mana, gets the kill. But KOO got the dragon.
It's another messy team fight where Fnatic, they want to fight it, but they don't have a teleport ready, so they have to run down with their members. They were staying around Yellowstar trying to bait, maybe force KOO Tigers to stay, and they just jump him. They kill him very early. Notice here how Yellowstar is very, very far forward, trying to just get a fight started.
This was really messy, but ultimately KOO made the right decision. Whenever you're trying to get pincered, you commit hard to one side. KOO gets the advantage there by killing Yellowstar, but in doing so, it gives Huni enough time to come down and join this fight. This time, though, during the cleanup, it was Febivin who picked up the kills. It is now a 4-kill LeBlanc, and the next time that happens, he will have a little bit more to say about the fight.
And we just saw the mid tower fall. What so often happens when you play Kassadin is you need strong side lanes. Because strong side lanes means the other team can just go mid lane and group on your Kassadin with no wave clear and take your mid tower. But these side lanes for KOO Tigers, they've been losing in the lane. Outside of those kills Smeb got in the team fight, he's not been able to do anything. So Fnatic group mid, took a free tower.
And we always say, Deficio, the side lanes oftentimes turn into 1v2 lanes because of the jungler presence. But with this Zac pick combined with the Kassadin pick, they're already weak in the mid lane, and the jungler cannot lend as much assistance as you would like to the side lane. Hojin being shut down has crippled most of this. It's crippled the weak point that already was there.
And we simply just see a very, very greedy comp for KOO Tigers in the sense to have Kassadin and Zac. Because again, when it comes to invading into the enemy jungle, pushing mid lane is the number one priority because it means you have two entrants you can move in and your mid lane can move first and help you in case there's a 2v2 fight going on. Kassadin can't do anything against the Blank alone when it comes to pushing, so he gets pushed into his tower. Zac can't do anything 1v1 against the Rek'Sai. So Fnatic had an easy 2v2 skirmish. They could always just win the mid lane and move into that jungle, look for the Zac over and over, and they've been doing it, and that's why they're ahead in gold.
And a lot of gold at that. 5,000 as we hit the 16-minute mark. Thanks to the towers and the kills. And Huni's teleport is now up and available. You guys have talked about how Fnatic want to look for fights. If KOO decide to engage, look at your mini-map. Fnatic are starting to surround KOO under this tower.
Yeah, this is looking to be a dive, but all teleports are up for KOO, so this could turn into a 5v5.
Gorilla's already gone low. The depth charge has been thrown out. Fate's Call has been used as well. Reignover is in a lot of trouble. He's not tanky enough to survive under the tower. Onslaught will keep KOO together. Huni continues to tank the tower. Fnatic have overreached, overbitten, and KOO have struck back. Reckless is down to 200, flashed away. And Smeb is looking for at least one more. That's a triple for Kuro. Kassadin has been activated, and that lead is shrinking.
How real is the KOO Tigers' magic? 6,000 gold deficit in the mid-game against KT Rollster. 5,000 deficit here, but Fnatic overcommits on a bad play. A 5v5 in the enemy turret is almost never a good idea. They were not tracking the teleports, and Reignover got trapped underneath the turret. So again, KOO actually find the fight they need, and a triple kill on a Kassadin is massive as far as their chances to come back in this game.
KOO Tigers is a team who's very good at reading where the aggressive plays are going to happen and have guys ready in time to respond.
They were so ready
for
that play.
But Fnatic, I feel, had every chance to back away from this one. Reignover flashed back in on the tower once he saw Alistar got pulled in by Kalista. Why would you ever do that to an Alistar with ulti, who's also getting Fates called in by Kalista? Look here, look again, look again. Fnatic goes in, they realize very quickly the Q Tigers are ready, so look at Reignover. Now he can just back away.
Disengage.
Why would you flash?
Burn both TPs, but at the same time, the play was called. Hooney's teleporting it onto the rec side tunnel. They all commit under the turret, but it is stuffed by Q Tigers when they're walking in here. They were ready to play. I think a huge mistake by Fnatic, but that is the type of mistake that gets Q back in the game.
I don't mind the call, but once you see that Hojin is waiting down there and double TP comes in instantly, you just disengage. Hooney cancels his TP, Reignover flashes away from the tower, not into the tower, and suddenly Fnatic gets out of this one, maybe lose at maximum one member of those two teleports, and it wasn't the end of the world. Now they just gave Q Tigers a way back into this game.
Yeah, that gold lead has shrunk significantly. Dragon's up in less than a minute. We'll need to see if Q want to put some more priority on that. Vision around the pit is still relatively good for Fnatic, thanks to that previous tower dive. But as it stands, Kua grouped around the middle. They may be tapping on Fnatic's mid outer turrets.
So we see the same for Q Tigers as we saw against KT. When it comes to river control, they have very few wards normally in the river itself. Now they finally move out and get some around the Baron. But Fnatic has been able to control that element of the map. And that's what you use to move between the lanes very quickly. Q Tigers had enough though to spot Fevermen come down to the bottom side before and react to the tower dive. And now again, they have these pings, at least towards the top side, where Smeb is trying now to be a Smeb pusher with four kills on river.
I'm happy to see the game playing out exactly as picks and bans dictated. Almost a kill a minute. Very dramatic team fights, and Reckless just takes a major chunk. Kuro's had that rod stacking for 5 minutes, got himself another needlessly large as well, and now has backup coming through the river. Fnatic, gonna be a little bit careful. Kuro can chase.
There's no turret there either.
Riptide's gonna at least slow Gorilla. Depth charge will knock Kuro up in the air. Reckless slicing Maelstrom is not even gonna do anything, but Febervin and Reignover have arrived. It's a 3v3, but Reckless
Great
has already
peel.
Been killed. Prey's gonna hop and skip forward, look for another. Febervin's got himself a kill, and Reignover is left for dead. Hooney's in the jungle, but Smeb was following him. Reignover's luckily tanky enough, thanks to those four kills, to actually get away.
Seems to me that Fnatic only has one thing in mind right now, and that's just keep moving forward and keep looking for very, very risky plays. They could see Q Tigers move down the river with these wards all the way down and stayed really far up the bottom lane. Had to then run when it was too late against the castle lane, who will keep chasing you, by the way. That
really?
Could have gone horribly wrong once again for Fnatic.
This game is now incredibly close, and we know that both teams have great tools to start fights and are willing to do so. As Quickshot said, one kill per minute. The Dragon is the next choice, yet at the time right now, Hooney is top lane trying to shove in lane while Q Tigers is starting this Dragon. This is actually pretty uncontestable for Fnatic.
Will be another advantage to Q, so another game where we see Q maybe a little slow out the gates. You can argue the team composition was a big reason for that today. But they find a way to punish opponents' mistakes. Look at the top wards that Fnatic are placing, though. We need to see how valuable these become in the next few minutes, because we know how Fnatic, and actually most European teams, like to play around those early barons. Yesterday, Origin did it to SKT.
And we just see the good and the bad about Fnatic and the way they like to play the game here at Worlds. With how aggressive they want to be constantly taking these fights, it's too much from time to time. They're not respecting what Q Tigers can do as a defense, and that's why Q Tigers, despite falling so far behind, again, are getting slowly but surely back in the game. One difference though, Reckless on this cannon is going to shut down the lane, but he is a utility AD carry. His damage is never going to be the thing that's going to carry Fnatic. If he can get a good ulti off in a fight, he can still be useful.
He did not see a good ulti when he was caught down the
lane.
Well,
he's been running away because he's always been overextending.
So let's see if the rest of Fnatic can pull themselves together. Hooney is going to take at least a hit or two there from Smeb. Spirit of Dread gives him some HP back. He's got that Frozen Art working towards a Trinity Force as well. And as we've mentioned, these teams are not particularly great at killing towers. So they're going to be looking for another engage, another fight. Summoner spells available basically across the board with the exception of Febervin. So we're going to see another explosive fight, Jeff.
So much of this is going to be about Kuro versus Febervin. We have a 5-0 Febervin with Death Cap, but also Kassadin late game can rift in, get a big magic shield, pop
just
the force pulse, and then
hourglass
and jump away. And it's actually relatively uncounterable for the LeBlanc unless LeBlanc has flank position for the other people in the fight. So Kassadin's kind of a LeBlanc assassin while LeBlanc is trying to assassinate others.
And Kassadin is going to build Athenes as his third item to get that mana back. When he gets a kill on assist, he will obviously restore a high amount of mana also with his W, so he can kind of burn his mana pool when he jumps around with his ulti to maximize that damage in the late game, and he can get it back then. He gets this mini reset basically by getting a kill on assist where he gets enough mana to use another fully stacked ulti for him. So late game Kassadin, if he gets to run crazy and get that first kill into second kill, can really win a team fight.
We're starting to get signals that this game might go to later than expected. Considering the team comps, Kassadin and Kalista going to scale really well in comparison to their counterparts, but what about the two teams as wholes? Like, who do we prefer? Is this gold lead for Fnatic enough, considering their team comp?
This gold lead definitely isn't that safe against the Kassadin on the other side, but it's still a substantial bullet. KOO Tigers, with their low wave clear composition, risk being run over since the only thing they can do is fight you when you try to go for their turrets. But because their fight was actually successful, they have prolonged the game, so to speak, but they still haven't made the winning play.
We're going to see two AD carries stick to the mid lane with the Hurricane. They are the best wave clear, basically, when it comes to sitting back safely from range, not looking at the LeBlanc distortion on towards the mini wave. She obviously wants to try and hide and create a pick for herself. So the two AD carries are going to sit and just push out mid lane. Because now for Fnatic, the play is going to be around Baron. You want to start setting up this Baron here with Pink Ward. You want to try and bait KOO Tigers to walk straight into you, and you can get a flank with Rooney to start a teamfight and instantly try and kill one of these carries for the KOO Tigers.
Got to be very careful, because if KOO have some vision, Hojin on that Zac will be able to engage from a long distance. Fnatic need extra deep wards to prevent a flyby or bounce in.
Fnatic actually has the wrong split push matchups right now. Rooney is set to split push against Smeb, and Febiven would want to be against Curl, because you saw Huni had to heavily respect the casting. There's no way he can kill him, but the casting can absolutely poke Huni down.
And that's the problem when Febiven doesn't run teleport, because you now are going to try and threaten Baron, so you need a TP on the bottom side. That can only be Huni, who's taking the one-on-one against the Kassadin. KOO Tigers can freely move Riven and Kassadin around the map and pick whatever matchup they want. So they're very happy right now, keeping like this. It's up to Fnatic then to set up the Baron and try and force a fight and get that flank in from Huni, but they're gonna see him recall from the bottom side as well and be like, guys, home guard incoming, be careful.
KOO is currently set up to force a response from Fnatic. At this current juncture, if they were able to continue to set Kassadin down, pick up as much farm as he wants against the Hecarim, he'll scale up until he gets his Athenes, maybe even some boots on top of that, hit 40% CDR on Kassadin and level 16, and have his Rift walk up every 1.6 seconds. So they're completely okay with that. Meanwhile, Fnatic will have to force Baron to stop that, which sets up another opportunity for KOO Tigers that is favorable.
And KOO Tigers knows everything that's going on. So what you see is Prey, it's a small thing, but he keeps always overextending almost in the mid lane to fast push his wave here to force Fnatic to always have a guy defending. Mid control is so key when it comes to setting up Baron. And there's always either Hojin or Gorilla just right behind him. For security, he's there in case something happens. Allow Prey to keep pushing. Or we might see a fight, and here's the flank.
Well, we do. Huni's found Prey. Prey's gone. Hojin wants to bounce, but it's going to need to be away. Gorilla will get dropped as well. And Fnatic punish the overextension in the mid lane, and they've peeled back the Baron.
Absolutely ideal from what Fnatic wanted there. They assassinate Prey without even needing Febiven. Now, Zac could do a flyover steal. That's one thing he can do, but it would have to be lucky. He's channeling. Here he comes.
Let's take a look. The elastic slingshot just to bounce away. Smeb has gone back in looking for Yellow Star. Will get stunned by Reckless. That's the third kill of this engage, but they have delayed and cancelled and stopped the Baron.
So Fnatic in the end just get three kills. KOO used teleport from the bottom lane, but instant cancel. Realized we're not going to win this fight, so he had to run all the way up from this bottom side. And Fnatic in the end values playing it probably safe, not risking Hojin, jumping in, trying to get a smite steal, get that one kill away. You always got to respect the Raven also stunning you in a Baron pit.
Yeah, the Baron itself, I think, was well respected by Fnatic, not overly risky. Curl, man, I know warding over the wall is tough, but Riftwalk, otherwise...
He's stacking
for the damage. Other than that, though, Fnatic found a really nice counter to KOO's play. They have the walk. They can run a pick composition. So instead of actually doing the Baron, while the split push is setting up, they got the damage onto Alistar, which actually pulled Prey up a little bit because he was wondering if he had to be in range to Fate's Call, and that exposed him to the teleport from Rooney. So Fnatic played that really well.
And some of you mentioned earlier how Fnatic keep Kennen in the mid lane because he's the guy who, you know, you're fine showing Kennen. He can just keep pushing that mid wave. It doesn't matter. He's showing himself. Febim was the guy to push out top and then go into the shadows, disappear. You can always keep top lane under control when you're setting up for Baron because it's the lane right next to Baron, obviously, so it's very easy to push it out. And that was just very smart setup by Fnatic. waiting for that one opportunity to get a flank for Huni. They did. It wasn't communicated by KOO. Maybe they were just too far out and couldn't react in time. But now there's no TP for Huni, and that's very important for him and the way Fnatic wants to engage.
Luckily, on the side of KOO, no TPs there either. So the map play is going to get reduced over the next few minutes. As far as Fnatic are concerned, though, it's all about that Baron. As we continue to see, there's some deep vision again in the jungle. Let's see if they can pull KOO towards them.
Baron is how Fnatic has gained most of their advantages against EDG to an absurd extent. Actually, they had a total goal differential of 35,000 against EDG. 29,000 of that was during Baron power plays. But in this particular juncture, 28 minutes in, Dragon is actually more important and easier. So they're moving towards that side of the map. You can see KOO is respecting it in turn.
Yeah, Fnatic have not got their hands on a single Dragon yet. So that buff will be quite powerful in denying the movement speed from KOO's team fight is also going to be very impactful.
Fnatic needs to be careful now, though, because KOO just pushed up the bottom lane, and Huni's showing himself.
Poor timing around Dragon.
Yeah, they know where he is. That means KOO can start this Dragon, and the rest of Fnatic, if they push up towards this mid lane,
Huni
they can
has no TP.
On.
Yeah, Huni has no TP right here, so I really question that decision from Fnatic. They had the advantage. They should have actually been bullying into the Dragon area and forcing KOO to fight them, because Dragon doesn't hit as hard as Baron. So at this stage in the game, you can actually force the Dragon and force KOO to come and fight them, in which case they get the cataclysmic team fight they've been looking for. Instead, they just allow KOO a Dragon for pretty much nothing.
Traditionally, though, European LCS teams, maybe to an extent NA LCS teams as well, do not fight around those third or oftentimes fourth Dragons. It's waiting until the very last moment and then trying to interrupt them.
I agree. Most of that, though, is when you have a deficit.
Wow! KOO does get chunked out.
Reynover
is just in the wrong place at the wrong time. Fnatic do not find a kill. And Reynover reading from the amazing style
yeah.
of top lane inner turrets.
I was about to say,
turrets are really dangerous.
I saw a Rek'Sai do exactly this yesterday as well, where you're just like, oh, I guess I'm just going to walk through this tower. It doesn't matter. And instantly you get just jumped on and your team can't help you. Really. Reynover has made some good plays in the early game. He often makes a lot of good plays in the early game, but one of the reasons he got the name Game Over in Korea was because once he had all these fantastic early game plays, around 20-25 minutes, he would kind of be too aggressive and just keep trying to force fights and keep trying to set up dives, and he would overextend. Hojin might do the same now, though.
Oh, Hojin, look at his passive pop. That's the cell division. Fnatic are not together, though. They're waiting for Yellowstar to get up. Huni and Reynover trying to buy time. They've killed themselves. They're Zap, and they're looking for more. Prey is on the retreat. He's got the life steal, though, and with Reckless down, Smeb is going huge. Yellowstar is late to the party. It's a triple kill for Smeb. KOO jumps over the wall, looking for Febavin and will not find him. 4-1 to KOO Tigers.
This is going to be Baron for the KOO Tigers. And I was about to say before that fight how deceptive this gold lead actually is for Fnatic. Reynover is on a poor scaling Rek'Sai full tank build and was 4,000 of the 6,000 gold advantage for Fnatic. Not to mention, KOO Tigers had 3 dragons to 0, so the 6% attack damage and ability power was all in the side of KOO Tigers. All of that together means the game is actually pretty damn even when you take before you take in the scaling of the champions. They killed the weakest member before this fight, and he really hasn't done much, but they burned a lot of cooldowns to do so. Plus, they didn't have their whole team here when they go in to kill the Blob.
Yeah, look at Huni's ulti to try and get that last hit on the Zac. It's when he only gets Gorilla after. So the carries right now has been untouched until Prey takes this damage, but he can flash out. Now Castellan is still alive. He has that Athena to get the mana back whenever he can just jump in and get a kill, and the Riven, of course, jumping in.
And also, one exhaust is greater than 3 ignites 35 minutes into the game. We see the use of the exhaust right there. KOO Tigers understands exactly when they can fight based on the cooldowns of the other team. That is one of their greatest strengths. And as soon as Huni used his ultimate on Hecarim on not KOO and not Prey, it was go time for KOO, and they capitalized.
We see why people praise KOO Tigers for being one of the best team fighting teams, if not the best team fighting team in Korea, because they know exactly what to do here. And Fnatic will look back at this game and say, we had a great start, good early plan, we played it really well, but then we just went too crazy with the plays we were trying to make. We group up to try and get one kill onto a support, onto a jungler, and that is not enough. That's not okay, because KOO Tigers punish you for that.
Well, KOO have already taken 2 towers during the course of this Baron buff. This inner turret will be the third, and Smeb is down that bottom lane going toe-to-toe with Huni on another potential tower. The gold lead is now completely insignificant at 1,000, and KOO are still using those Baron-empowered minions. Is this going to be the fourth tower in a row here, just falling over like dominoes?
I mean, as far as efficiency of champions plus items as well as dragon bonuses, ooh, I'd give them a pretty big gold lead right here. And we know because of these team compositions, they're fight comps. Fnatic, they only stop these turrets going down if they fight. And if they lose a fight as they've lost the last three or four fights, the game is over.
So pressure on Febivant to pull the magic out of his hat. He did it against AHQ in a similar situation after Fnatic had given up the early lead that they had generated. And one big team fight can still swing this either way.
But who will Fnatic focus? QSS on Kalista, and Kalista's not even the important member for Two Tigers now. Kassadin and Riven are dealing the majority of the damage in these big team fights. Most likely have to just try and take down Smep. If he goes a little bit too far forward, you jump him instantly and you try and burst him. He's the only guy who can't really defend himself. He has no defensive items, only the shield from the Bloodthirster. He might be the only guy you can just completely one-shot.
So let's see if Fnatic agree. Hojin charging up that elastic slingshot, threatening the dive. Fnatic scatter to minimize the risk. Tower loses 50% of its hit points in Koop. Push up to the middle lane. Smep and Gorilla, both melee, they're underneath. Again, Hojin charges and cancels. Backs away. He's got himself some MR and Febivant. Unable to find those two chains. Hojin walks out.
This game is very heavily looking in the favor of KOO Tigers. And it is kind of answering a lot of our questions before this tournament. Does KOO Tigers have weaknesses? Yes. Their early game has been giving up so much against these better teams, but they're still able to turn it around. It's not to say that their early game is the right plan. I still think there are several flaws in the way they play the early game, but time and again, they are able to find the windows with massive gold discrepancies and turn these games around.
But the KOO Tigers faced teams like CLG and the Flash Wolves and so on in Group A. They didn't feel like they had to wait for late game to win games. They could challenge them in the laning phase in the early game and had super bloody games. When they face KT and Fnatic, they very clearly respect what they can do in the early game, so they take the more consistent, passive style at first and wait for late game where they want to try and punish them.
I think the game is right here. It depends on how well KOO can flank. Yellowstar already cut out of position.
Yellowstar's going to get dropped here. The rest of Fnatic are simply not nearby. And Yellowstar got his ultimate off, and that was it. Now Smeb, he's looking to flank both Reckless and Rainover. Reckless has been able to flash over the walls, being chased down. The Wind Slash will deal enough damage to allow Kuro to kill him. A flash forward into the Keystrike will allow the stun to connect on Huni, and Huni's now in trouble. Smeb looks for Rainover. All of a sudden, Fnatic are coming apart at the seams, and Kusei, screw the dragon, will take the base instead. 30-second death timers, they've got themselves one inhibitor already, and will peel backwards, holding the gold lead now. Most likely a dragon on the exit as well.
Definitely gonna get a dragon as well. Huni safe teleport as soon as they realize Yellowstar were completely caught out of basically nowhere.
Great play by KOO once again. And a mistake from Fnatic.
And this is also why teams pick Kassadin. So much of Kassadin that we've seen at Worlds has been run over in the early game, hasn't been able to keep up.
But Kassadin in this game should have been run over in the early game.
Yep.
They were so far down. Reno had 4 kills on this Rek'Sai. He had done almost everything correct in the early game. They were pushing every single lane. And then the team goes down to that bottom lane and says, hey, let's 5-on-5 dive at like 17 minutes. Even though we had a chance to run away, they went for it. That was the first big fight KOO Tigers won. 4 kills went over to the Kassadin, and suddenly they could respond to everything Fnatic did. And you can also look back at that Baron call for Fnatic. Should they have stuck to the Baron and try and get it? Or was it the right call to peel away and get that one kill on Smep and say that was about it, we want to play it safe?
Or even the third dragon when Fnatic had a large lead and could have forced KOO Tigers into a fight. But now, Rainover, but he is a long ways and there is no escape.
No, you're not going to get away from Kassadin. Febivant will get in range to at least watch his teammate become game over.
And Prey is helping.
Well, kill secured, that's what counts. 38 seconds before Rainover can try help his fellow teammates. KOO, they're pushing down the bottom. So Huni with teleport is pushing against those super minions. That will help a little. I still feel like KOO's gonna take a base.
They gotta give up the second inhibitor.
Love when Zach runs in.
Sometimes the animation doesn't quite work with Zach.
I like this one more.
It and he runs. It's very fun. Baron up in 15 seconds. Rainover does have a tunnel up behind where KOO is, and that is what Smeb is going to destroy right now, I think.
So by Rainover taking that red buff, he got three wards placed behind that KOO Tigers might not expect to be there because they just randomly found Rainover. But they should know there's something behind him at least. They don't know where.
Some respect from KOO when they heard the farm alarm.
Fnatic has to win this one. They have to win this fight right here, right now.
There is no margin for error. Febivin's looking for the flank and Hooney's looking for prey. Febivin's dropped to half HP and KOO, he's coming from the Baron pit. He's jumped onto four members of Fnatic and so is Hojin. Yellow Star's down. Febivin manages to get the distortion as the onslaught of shadows will send prey back to the shadows. Hojin gets his passive pop. The cell is divided and KOO may be too. That's a double kill for Hooney.
The
pink blobs will get squashed, and Fnatic, they start the Baron. Reckless is on it. Have Fnatic done it?
Wow, what a bold fight there by Fnatic. This fight may... it's going to prolong the game. They're not going to win straight off this one because they are down two inhibitors, but they get the kills on their priority targets. I can't wait to see that fight again.
KOO Tigers had no idea where the wards were behind them, so they thought they had a safe way to escape. Moving towards that top side, Hooney shows up instantly, and the big fight is on. It took such a long time for KOO Tigers to kill anyone in that fight.
Deficio, Kennen had Steric Gate
in that
team fight, and it did proc while he was trying to be assassinated. The ultimate evolution of AD carry builds here at Worlds. But this game is still so interesting. That fight, Febivin had to try so hard not to get assassinated by KOO, but the cast in LeBlanc was a sideshow to the focus on to prey. Not to mention, Smeb was pushing a wave, so he was incredibly late to this fight. Look, Smeb has to use a lot of his burst onto Yellow Star.
So that basically wins the fight for Fnatic, that Smeb is so busy on the top side, because what KOO did was he jumped in and he instant popped Hourglass, so his damage obviously went down. He couldn't do anything while sitting there and had to jump out of the fight as well. Normally you want Kassadin and Riven to dive together. So when Kassadin deals the damage, he pops Hourglass. Riven is there to follow up with her stun and her damage until Kassadin is back out of that Hourglass.
Hooney's
but because
trouble.
They were split up, went wrong. And Hooney now, oh, you're farming very far out.
He also doesn't have mana to use many spells. Whew.
KOO, if they chased, may have been surrounded. Fnatic have got themselves a squad in the river. Now, we know they've got Baron buff. Dragon's up in 2 minutes, and KOO are threatening aspects. Smeb can split push with his TP, and Fnatic have a minute and a half to figure out what they want to do. GA also on Smeb, so even more power to these extended team fights.
Yeah, this is going to be Fnatic trying to wait out some summoners, and hopefully for them start setting up for this Dragon. They have to fight for it. They won't have TP ready, though, from Hooney, so the engage is very, very hard to pull off on their side, but there's no flash for prey, so they might be able to one-shot him, but you cannot invest too much because Riven and Kassadin are the main damage dealers in these late games fights. You even see prey building now.
Yeah.
Straight HP. He's like, I'm doing my job just by basically having them jump on me.
He
trying
actually
to
sold
me.
His QSS for that giant spell. I think it's because he's mainly been getting killed by Hooney, Rainover, and Reckless, so he actually hasn't been getting hurt by the longs. That is a pretty inefficient purchase as far as prey is concerned, so that hurts their gold efficiency a little bit. This is Fnatic's moment, though. The trick here is Smeb can answer with TP, and the only way Fnatic makes something out of this push mid lane is if they dive the inhibitor turret. I think they're actually just going for ward control in the Dragon Air.
Yeah.
That's the most important thing.
Fnatic got inhib back in the bottom side, so they now have a slow push building up. It's a very big wave that's going to build up. That means they only have to worry about top side.
Yeah.
But again, you have no teleport, so if Hooney leaves to clear that wave, KOO can go straight for Dragon in 30 seconds.
This is a huge worry because the teleport of Hooney is actually not synced up right now, so they're either giving up, and they have to give up basically one or two inhibitors for the fifth Dragon. Hooney's running over right now. He needs to charge the Dragon Pit immediately.
Fnatic is so far out here. There are wards behind them Smeb can teleport onto if he wants to start the fight, but Hojin also needs to find a way to get the engage off without Fnatic just obviously seeing him out there in the open. Hooney's moving over now. Smeb is going back to that top side. Dragon is alive in 5 seconds
this
from now.
This is so huge. Smeb is actually not here at the start of the fight, so if Fnatic were to catch Prey and kill him before the teleport completed, they could win the fight. They are forcing KOO in. Hojin will be able to jump into this pit. This is the fight of the game.
The teleport is coming down for Smeb, and the dragon looks like it will get secured. Picked up by Fnatic, but Febivin is forced away. Smeb will not find the kill, and Febivin jumps in the pit. They've traded AD carry for support, but Febivin's down as well. Reckless needs to survive and tank. The shields are there, but there may not be enough. He's flashed out, and KOO chases him. That's a triple, looking for more. Hooney's getting run down, and Hooney will not find anything. A quadra for KOO, and that's the game.
What a game this was. So many massive team fights. It comes up to the apocalyptic moment. Fnatic has to force the dragon. They do interrupt Hojin, but in using that crowd control, they enable KOO and the rest of KOO to win the team fight. The death timers are long enough. This should be the game.
Smeb managed to TP in behind Febivan, and he took him out completely. Febivan did no damage in that team fight, and Fnatic, they need him. Late game, KOO Tigers, they deserve this one.
Well, Nexus turrets are falling. Minions have conga lined in, and the cool, calm, collected KOO Tigers will pick up their first victory and are one step closer to an all-Korean final with SKT.
5,000 gold down, 15 minutes into the game, were the KOO Tigers, but by the end of it, they are up in gold, and ultimately they did the only thing that matters. They killed the Nexus.
They didn't. Febivan in that last fight, he dealt 300 damage on a late game LeBlanc because the flank from Smeb came in. He didn't expect it. He got stunned. He got basically taken out of the fight. It lost it for Fnatic, but obviously it wasn't that fight alone. It was everything building up to it because they were down 4 dragons to 0. They had such a good early game. Seemed like there was a clear plan for Fnatic. They punished that greedy Kassadin and Zac combo that can't do anything around the mid lane until we start getting these 5-on-5 very aggressive tower dives where KOO Tigers always had teleport ready. They saw Fnatic move down and it was like there was only one way for Fnatic. They was just keep going forward. We just have to go for this dive now.
A little too eager maybe in terms of their team comp and feeling that gold lead, while it was very, very sizable, it wasn't big enough to thwart the bad tower dive at, what was it, 22 minutes, that then skyrocketed KOO in terms of gold and power.
Against like Alistar and Zac as well, the CC.
I think so much we have to talk about as well is just how much pressure these players are under and how difficult it is to perform optimally in this situation. Fnatic knows how much the European fans want them to win, right? KOO is actually coming in with a lot of confidence because the only team to beat a team from the LCK was KOO Tigers, right? Other than that, it's looking like it's going to be an all-Korean showing, and they have the experience of playing calm when they are behind.
And talking about that, pull up the replay of that last team fight because completely game-changing. This was the decision from Fnatic to start Dragon.
Right, so for Fnatic, they have to just go for the Dragon instantly.
It's the
they
right
know
decision.
It. Look here, first of all, what Yellowstar is going to do to Hojin to interrupt the slingshot, but then pay attention to where Smeb is coming in behind Febivan. We can just roll the clip, and you're going to have to see here what happens to Febivan.
This is the fight that basically decides the game. Because of the teleport timing, Febivan doesn't get to do damage in this fight. Unfortunately, I think we're having a bit of a technical glitch.
No,
replay
we
should play.
Another thing for Fnatic, obviously, is the fact that Hecarim doesn't have teleport. So you can flank.
I was so looking forward to that fight, DeFizio.
You were.
We're going to try again. Let's see what happens. Because, again, Fnatic, they had their backs against the wall, absolutely had to win that fight, and it didn't happen. So, unfortunately, we will have to watch that or maybe let the analysts take a look at it a little later.
300 damage he dealt.
Yeah.
And it's the first fight that he really got zoned out. Yeah. Earlier in the Baron pit, Febivan's flank allowed Fnatic to pick up some of that damage and actually win that then lane to the Baron.
Yeah. The team compositions were bouncing back a little bit as long as Smeb was being handled in the team fights, which is why it's so important that he jumped on the Blanc before the Blanc could jump on him.
Yeah,
that
exactly.
is actually very much a skill matchup in the truest sense of the word. And Febivan was outplayed his first death of the game.
He played almost perfect. Almost perfect the entire game long. And then, sadly for him, he's the guy getting jumped.
Yeah, I want to talk about the Kassadin pick a little bit again, too, because, yes, Kassadin does have big weaknesses. But if the win condition of Kassadin is just pick up some kills somewhere in the game, is that really so hard to fulfill? Because I feel like Kassadin, I feel like he is over-criticized in K chaotic games where you will be having team fights. He can do this. And by the end of the fight, by the end of the game,
sure.
11-112, huge amounts of damage. The fight!
All right, off to this replay. We will hit to the analyst desk. But yeah, talk us through, Jez.
So, Gorilla gets a perfect knockup on Febiven, and then Smep flashes in and basically takes him out of the fight. You can't really do anything as Lebanc here, and then the damage for Fnatic is too low because he was going to use the late game damage. The cannon is not going to do a whole lot. An almost full tank Hecarim is obviously not going to carry the fight either. So that's what Ku Tigers uses to win.
Yeah, there were a couple good plays that happened in that fight because Fnatic also killed Prey right away. Prey only did 300 damage to champions and then that fight as well.
Magic number.
But Febiven was more valuable than Prey in that situation, and Kuro and Smeb could just keep resetting their deck.
Again and again and again.
And exactly what they did. So, first blood has been struck, and it's Fnatic that are down 0-1. We're going to head over to the analyst desk. Talk a little bit more about that very exciting matchup.
Thank you, Quickshot. There was so much blood in that game. There was more than first blood. There was second, third, fourth, fifth, and sixth. KOO coming away with a victory, though.
KOO.
And Monty, you promised me something weird. You did, and we got it immediately in Champion Select with the Zach pickup. Talk to me about this, because it's such an interesting leap for him to make to that champion. Oh, please.
He's played a lot of weird junglers at times. Sion, Trundle, he pulls out this stuff. And I didn't really like what happened in the early game. I think Fnatic clearly outclassed them early, which I think is one of Fnatic's big win conditions in this series as a whole, because I don't think they can survive in the late game against KOO, so they have to have these big leads.
Yeah, Fnatic with this competition, it's like going to a casino and placing $1 million on the early game. It's like, coin flip right now. If we make
Ignite on your mid laner.
Ignite on your mid laner. You don't take advantage of somehow Zac was level 4 giving up his blue buff to a level 7 Kassadin. Like, if the game gets to that point where you have the 5,000 lead, you need to just close out, and you just can't afford to make these mistakes where you, get a little greedy. Twice rain over, fantastic early game pathing, farming, ganking, but then a couple of times he overextends and kind of gives up that lead, and you can't afford to do that.
Jump in here, bro.
I think KOO did a really good job of strategy of what to do. So they blind pick their top, blind pick their bot. That kind of sucks. It's instantly solved by lane swapping, and this instantly solves the whole jungle mismatch with Zac versus Rek'Sai, which also sucks. So they have a lot of early game that is just not fun. They fix that with this lane swap. However, I think this is the KOO passiveness that comes into play. They actually see Reckless and Yellowstar push out in base, and it takes KOO 15 seconds to go, oh wait, I don't want to hit this turret, we're going to back two. And now it's the standard. And this is where KOO doesn't want to be. And then you see Rek'Sai just completely destroy mid lane, get first blood top. Like, that's just not where they wanted to be.
That must have been some sort of miscommunication. That's really the only way that something like that happens. Maybe one player decided they didn't want to go into that lane after all. But yes, it was very poor, and it did set them very far behind.
Thematically, though, that lane swap kind of helps Fnatic because the strongest lane matchup disparity is the top laners against each other. Huni and Smep kind of weren't all that relevant in the early game. Huni with a very tank-heavy build actually does a lot more in these early team fights than a Riven that builds damage from behind. Then again, Rainover could spend all his attention in the mid laner. Suddenly, Febiven was super far ahead in CS pressure, and that kind of still allowed Fnatic to take control of the game. Suddenly, though, it wasn't enough for them to snowball, but I think the lane swap was still, in that sense, pretty risky because your main carry, Smeb, he's playing from behind. You're already playing a rough matchup in the mid lane that constantly Rainover doesn't even care about wards. He just hovers there in full vision, says, well, you're not going to farm. I don't care if you see me. I will still outlevel the Zac somehow. I don't know how that he stayed a level ahead there, but yeah, Fnatic, they were ahead in the early to mid game.
Yeah, you saw Fnatic on your screen there strategizing after a very tough loss. We have to remember how back and forth this was and how set up they were. You mentioned, well, they needed to get leads. They did get those leads. They almost got their money back and more from that casino. And I want to point specifically to the jungle. Coming into today, Rainover had been a part of all but one first blood for the team. He's now 9 of 10 first bloods, and Huni, 7 of 10. Krepo, yesterday you said that somebody else was the king of first blood. I don't know if you can. I don't know if you can defend that anymore.
The king's a first blood. You know what's a king to a god? If you have playing here, I call SKT that. But if you have Fnatic playing here, like the gods of first blood, but sadly enough, KOO weren't
wasn't enough
non-believer, and they just won the game anyways.
Well, I actually think that Fnatic's strategy coming in was very good. They saw the weakness. They wanted to go for these very aggressive summoner spells, try and take the fight to KOO early. But we really saw the problem there in not having an additional teleport in the late game. The split push was way too much for Fnatic to handle. They just didn't have very many options on how to actually close that game. And the dragons just kept letting it over time and time again.
I have to push us forward to the replays because we talk so much about how these teams are going to pair up in the early game. Passivity versus aggression. So first off, 10 minutes and 30 seconds into the game, 4-for-3 for Fnatic in the bot lane. But KOO is the aggressor here.
I actually like this because, yeah, KOO makes the first move here. And if you see, the jungler is actually the first one moving, and Rek'Sai is moving to mid lane. So KOO gets the start to this really, really well. However, we see like Huni TP's in right now, like way before KOO does, even though KOO's the one setting up this play. And this gives Huni, you know, 2 to 3 seconds of damage before Smeb even gets in. So this gives enough time for mid and jungle to come down to this.
Well, this is fine up until right here. Huni just turns it around. Great Hecarim ultimate, right, to turn this fight. But there's no reason for KOO to do that. LeBlanc, you have to know, is going to be coming down out of that mid lane. So don't get greedy. Don't overcommit. Just back off right after you get a kill or two.
Yeah, and the reverse actually ends up happening a little later where Fnatic sets up a good play around a potential tower dive, but then the play just looks too good, too juicy, and that's usually when you don't want to go for it because Reignover goes in for an aggressive flash.
Yeah, it was only 6 minutes later.
Yeah, 6 minutes later, I believe we have the replay, hopefully, if that's still working over here.
Oh, yeah, the replays have been a little wonky, but here it is right here.
And you can see it right here, good zoning here, but Yellowstar, he knows he can go for these trades because there's a threat of a dive looming already, so there's nothing the Prey and Gorilla can do here except run. So they get so much damage. Right now, the map belongs to Fnatic. This is okay too, but then Reignover going for the flash here to follow up aggressively, that is just too much. When a teleport comes behind you, imagine just Reignover pathing towards the teleport location of Smeb. Smeb would have had defensively flashed out. Then the re-engage would go straight into the utility AD carry's ultimate. That would have been a beautiful play where suddenly Fnatic controls the map. But instead, you lose your CC, you don't hold it for the carries, and that is actually one of the big things we've seen this entire game. People not holding their crowd controls for when the carries comes in. When you play these CC-heavy compositions, very often you forget to keep count, but you need at least one or two CCs later on in these fights, because otherwise Smeb can clean up, Feb can clean up a couple of fights, and that is lack of communication, maybe the pressure of the stage getting to these teams.
Definite lack of communication there with Reignover flashing in while the rest of the team is backing out of that turret.
Very bizarre call there by Reignover, especially because he knew that the Fates call had already been used. He knew Alistar still had Pulverize up, so he basically just got double knocked up under turret, and that was it.
I think this is what Fnatic is good and really bad at the same time. Like, this is where I'm talking about they need accurate calls, because they did a lot of really good aggression where they're turning around fights, where they're keeping up with things, and then this is a perfect example of they weren't accurate enough. The dive looked really good at the start, and the TP came in. They need a cut and run. They already got the advantage of the map there.
Final thoughts, Krebo.
Yeah, just a great coach once said clear calls, good plans, but it didn't get his team anywhere, so maybe Fnatic needs even more than that.
Right, yeah, they need a new mantra. Well, we're going to step away while the teams reset for game two in the semifinal series between KOO Tigers and Fnatic, so don't go anywhere.
What are you doing? You know there will be consequences. You remember the word consequences?
Help!
Onslaught of Shadow splits everyone from KOO away.
Feverman
2 for 1. Feverman wants to clean up. It's a triple for Smith. He's on the retreat. He's got the life steal though. And with Reckless down, Smith is going huge. Yellowstar is late to the party.
Riven.
But Febervin's down as well. Reckless needs to survive and tank. The shields are there, but there may not be enough. He's flashed out, and Kuro chases him. KOO Tigers one step closer to an all-Korean final with SKT. We'll be right back.
back, everyone, to Brussels, Belgium, in our second game between the KOO Tigers and Fnatic. KOO Tigers are on the board, 1-0. We're swapping sides here. Fnatic moving to the red side. Krepo, this is the one team that we've seen abandon or at least try and separate the two power picks of GP and Mord from the red side. What are you expecting to see here this time around?
Yeah, last game, obviously, KOO were on the red side, and they banned out Gangplank, Mordekaiser, Elise, the three best bans you could potentially do. I don't think Fnatic will repeat this. They seem really comfortable just hitting key picks in opposing team strategy. Sadly for them, KOO's champion pools are pretty deep overall, but I think this may be a game where Gangplank won't get through, but Mordekaiser may get through, and we'll have to see how well Prey has potentially played that, because Reckless has been spamming it over in Korea when he was in the boot camp, and we'll need to see if KOO's afraid of this, if they're going to change their ban strategy. At the other hand, though, they were comfortable playing whatever champions were left open, so they may actually just be fine banning these champions on blue side.
So let's zero in on one of those matchups, the top lane, Smeb versus Huni. Smeb came out swinging and basically saying, I don't care, I'm going to pick Riven blind into Huni.
I mean, Fnatic did this actually in the quarterfinal match as well. That's very cocky to blind pick a Riven in that way, but Smeb is very confident in his skills against Huni, and it really showed. I think Huni, he got delayed because he had to build that Frozen Heart, couldn't build that Trinity Force faster, and Smeb had some great TPs, multi-kills on this Riven. He's a very, very, very good Riven player.
I'm really glad that we got to see, like, Smeb doing what he does, like, doing really, really, really well on Riven. And then I'm also glad we got to see Fnatic. Rek'Sai did get that gank off, so they did have slightly better synergy, but we still saw Smeb taking control of the Riven, and I was just happy we saw both sides.
Yeah, a lot of things went to Chakra, at least how we expected. KOO coming out on top, though, and that's a crushing blow for Fnatic. To be up 7-8K gold at one point and be in control of that game and have it fall from grasp, probably, what would you be looking for this team to do on a larger scale in order to secure a victory this time around if they can create that lead?
Well, Fnatic kind of tunnels on these, like, theme comps, I guess I'll call it, because they're not really well-rounded. Like, in that conference, since they didn't have any wave clear, they didn't really have much AoE besides, like, the LeBlanc distortion. So I really want to see more well-rounded ones that have some kind of wave clear, some kind of, like, peeling in a team fight potential, and not just all in, we're going to press R and kill one guy, which is what their comps normally look like.
And I think Fnatic should go back to double teleport. We saw what KOO can do it in a late game. If Fnatic are playing these crazy engage compositions where they have a lot of crowd control, adding another dimension in terms of flanking with that teleport could mean maybe not so much on a LeBlanc, but if everyone ends up on a different champion, I just want to see the teleports matched at least. So even if things don't go as planned in the early snowball game, you can still match that split push, because KOO, they got a big advantage in the like later parts of the mid game with those teleports.
Well, that's the question, right, for Fnatic. Are they going to do that? Because punishing the early game and nearly winning is exactly what Fnatic did. Do they want to go blow for blow on a team that I think is a better team fighting team and better at using globals than they are?
We'll see if they can leave themselves a little bit more leeway when it comes to closing out a game if they can't secure another lead. As we send it to the casters for game 2, Yellowstar tells us that when it comes to fighting KOO, you have to face them head on.
KOO is a team that likes to play around the globals. I mean, they play with double TP, with the supports that can roam a lot, and he can move really fast on the map. So they really want to create skirmishes and those small fights. And I know that in 5v5, in a team fight, when it happens, they might not be as good as in skirmishes, because I've watched the games against KT, and this is where they got they lost the game.
May have lost them games against KT, but it just won a game for them against Fnatic, the opening of the series. Prey has already got one of those books ticked, saying Fnatic take it back to the library, because once they closed that game out, the crowd was stunned. Red side picks and bans were about to jump into Tificio, and we've heard our analyst desk talk about it. How does it change now for Fnatic?
Obviously, when it comes to these Mordekaiser Gangplank bans, KOO Tigers is a team who tend to ban it on blue side, especially the Mordekaiser. 8 out of 11 games now, they ban Mordekaiser themselves. Because I think due to them having a lot of, should we call them crazy picks or new picks you're not really expecting, or due to them trusting their ability to play more standard compositions, they don't need to trade like a Mordekaiser for Gangplank, don't want to risk it. Seems to be the strategy they were running against KT at least, so I wouldn't be surprised to see them just ban away Mordekaiser and Gangplank potentially themselves.
Yeah, and I think it's really important that Fnatic has a pretty evolved strategy for the red side pick ban here, because there are so many advantages the blue side team gets, and they have to be looking at this like an away game. They have to steal a game on red side if they want to win the series. Now they've lost their home court advantage from being the higher seed.
And in the last game, Rainover managed to get his jungle pick, the red side. we were talking before the game, okay, what is Reynover going to play if Rek'Sai and Elise is gone? Is he going to go for that Olaf pick we've seen back in Europe? Is he going to try and play Elise Sin? He hasn't played it all year long. And we have to go all the way back to when he was on IM number 2 and IM number 1 he used to play it. On blue side, you should be able to secure that pick for yourself, the priority jungler, and often ban away one of them yourself or expect Elise to be banned on red side and then you first pick a Rek'Sai. That would leave Reynover in a situation where he has to find something else to play. And this might be where we get to see what he can pull out. We saw Zach from Hojin.
Well, Zach ended up working well in the later stages of the game. Crowd is definitely trying to send their energy and love around the venue. We're going to jump into picks and bans for games two in just a couple of moments and see how these teams prioritize. Because the game that was remade against EDG, Fnatic left both Mordekaiser and GP through. We know KOO has had that penchant to ban it on blue side, but maybe.
So
KOO can surprise, not ban it this time, and catch us all a little off guard.
Well, EDG saw that Fnatic were okay leaving it open and take the trade. So EDG went Mordekaiser. Normally, you'd always go for Gangplank because he does really well into the Mordekaiser as well. But after EDG saw that and the remake happened, they're like, oh, we're not going to do this again.
Not worth it.
They banned it on blue side, not want to risk that trade. They trusted more in their more standard picks.
Yeah, the fact, though, that you normally take Gangplank before the Mordekaiser, and even with that knowledge, Fnatic was willing to let a trade go through, means that they could be willing to let this go through once more. Reckless has played maybe more Mordekaiser than anybody else. When it first went over to Korea for his boot camp, nearly 2 months ago when the patch first hit that they were playing Worlds on, he was first one on the train. And I think they're okay actually going into that matchup.
And I think also we have to look at Febiven in the mid lane, because analysts just talked about how they wanted double teleport to be a thing for Fnatic. Febiven on this LeBlanc, I think we look at the last game and we look at the first 20 minutes as one game in itself. And it paid off to have offensive summoners, Ignite in three different lanes, super aggressive, try and force that 2v2 fight around the mid lane. Reynover ganked KOO like three or four times early and then invaded into the jungle. That paid off for Fnatic, and they should have been able to close that game out or gone towards a Baron and not taken these tower dives, which were so telegraphed that KOO Tigers could respond. Late game, we did see the problem, though, with double teleport. And the funny thing is, I almost feel like when Fnatic is running a more standard comp in the sense of a control mage in the mid lane with a teleport for Febiven and a carry who can deal damage for Reckless, so it's not all about Huni snowballing. I often feel like that Fnatic team looks a little bit better in the sense that they can play more risk, or they can play more slow. They don't have to go all in the early game like we saw before.
Well, just a quick update, guys. We did have a chat to the production team and our referees and our QA off air and backstage regarding the wards that could not see each other. And when vision is unequal, a green ward can see a pink ward, but the pink ward cannot see the green ward. We will always pause. Now, when wards cannot see one another, we do not pause because of the map geometry. So when it is not clear if it is geometry or a ward bug, we will only pause if this is a severe impact on the game. In this case, each time LeBlanc roamed down, she was spotted by a KOO ward near the dragon entrance ramp, which is why the impact was not severe and did not result in a pause.
Yeah, well, also, I was going to check it in the game, and when I toggled the wards, the green ward couldn't see the pink ward, and the pink ward couldn't see the green ward, which is different than the ward that was paused in the Baron pit earlier in the tournament. Still, something to keep your eyes on.
It is, and something we'll be keeping an eye out for as we continue through the series. And of course, as we saw, it was the decision to tower dive that got punished, but LeBlanc had been spotted early. And, you know, some props to Febiven. Analyst Des was talking about maybe Febiven picking up that second teleport to Fischio. What's your take on that? Is it going to be dependent very much on how much map pressure they want, or did you like the Ignite?
I think for his LeBlanc pick against the Kassadin, I think it was okay for the early game. It's a very risky strategy, obviously, for Fnatic, but they paid off for them in the early game. The reason they lost the game was not due to not having a double teleport situation. They lost the game because they went over-aggressive and went into tower dives they shouldn't have gone into. And KOO got kills, Smep got kills from it. That was where it went really wrong. Obviously, it didn't help not having double teleport. But as I said before, I like Febiven running teleport because it means Fnatic doesn't have to go all in the early game. And they can play more for late game as well.
Well, interesting that KOO actually bans Rek'Sai here. Since they would have been able to first pick it, that blocks Fnatic from forcing a first pick.
They're going to first pick Tahm Kench for Gorilla.
Yeah, they could.
The best Tahm Kench player, in my opinion, so far at Worlds has been Gorilla. So I think this is good from KOO Tigers.
Well, also because Febiven has been assassinating so many people, but at the same time, the block is already in the ban thing. I actually think if there is a weakness for Tahm Kench, it's against heavy AoE teams.
Yeah.
And since they've already banned away the best assassin, there's a chance that's what Fnatic goes for.
And we so rarely see these AoE teams, like Rumble is being played very little by Marin, basically, is the only one so far. Another thing, we haven't seen Reckless play Kalista at the World Championship yet. Fnatic is one of the teams who bans it the most. So KOO Tigers are basically saying, normally here you would pick Kalista on the side of Fnatic and be like, okay, you get Tahm Kench, we get Kalista, we have to take that trade. I wonder if Fnatic's gonna go for it this time around. If not, you risk KOO Tigers getting that one as well, and suddenly there's a lot of power picks going to their side. I think this is the perfect start for KOO Tigers.
First pick.
In theory though, Fnatic should be aware of it because of the pension that KOO Tigers have shown for Tahm. It will not go for the Kalista. It's likely giving that up to Prey and instead take the Ash.
Yeah. We were wondering if Reckless and Prey were going to be taking away each other's favorite AD carry so far at Worlds. KOO Tigers either picked Ash or had a band away from them in the majority of their games. But it's not like Reckless can't play Ash. He played it before anyone else did as far as the European LCS is concerned.
Yeah.
Played it right away in the summer split, and Fnatic can play around it quite well.
And it is a good AD carry pick into Kalista, at least when it comes to trading in the laning phase, and then level 6 trying to set up that TP gank with your arrow and use that. So Fnatic has a 2v2 lane that, if they're running double teleport, can be super impactful because they are so good at diving towers and setting up ganks, both Alistar and Ash, in the way they can force the play onto KOO Tigers, then teleport in. But we do also have to see what Reignover wants to play in the jungle, because we had the Rek'Sai, we had the Elise ban.
Well, you've got a number of very difficult to kill champions for KOO Tigers. Hojin will lock in Zac for his second appearance on the world stage. Kalista to follow. And the next question as well, Fnatic, will they leave that counter pick for Huni in the top lane or for Febiven in the mid lane? These next two will give us that answer.
I would prefer to see counter pick for Huni in the top lane because it's very important.
Agreed.
You can win that lane so you can transition that pressure to the bottom side where you have your Ashe and your Alistar. Azir would be a fine pick, fine blind pick, in my opinion. Kassadin might come in against it though, which is a good matchup, but you can still push him down to tower.
I actually like Viktor a lot more, mainly because of how good Kuro is at Viktor. Now, Kuro did play Azir in the group stage, but as far as the summer split was concerned in the LCK, he was 0-6, and I think this denial pick provides a little bit more value. I think Azir and Viktor generally fulfill the same wave clearing role, with Azir having slightly better assassination, but Fnatic only wants... Oh man, they go for Azir anyway.
So, the
they
thing
only want the AoE damage.
The thing about Azir as well though against a Zac is when Zac blobs in towards you, if you can try and shoot him away with your own wall from the Azir, you can stop a lot of his crowd control from happening. Obviously, you have to be very, very good, and Febiven has played a ton of Azir before and has shown good moves with it. I also just think he's basically saying it, I want to pressure this mid lane. No matter what you're playing, I'm going to push it. I'm going to push it because Skarner is a jungler. In terms of 1v1, he's pretty strong. Like when it comes to a skirmish, especially if he can fight around the crystals for himself. Ganking-wise, pre-level 6 though, he's... pretty
well,
useless.
We've seen Skarner once before this tournament, and it left a whole lot to be desired. And we'll see how good that Impale will be. On the bright side, you have double the value. If Tahm Kench swallows somebody and you impale a Tahm Kench,
you pull two people.
You pull two people.
Yeah.
Next level. I mean, it could be top lane Skarner if they want to surprise us, but KOO Tigers will be denying Skarner any chance of Impale. Smeb will run Fiora and say, I dare you to pick Riven. And Kuro will round out the composition with that Vigor. I really like what KOO Tigers have put together.
Few things though about KOO Tigers comp. Again, it's going to be so much about Gorilla on this Tahm Kench because we know Kuro wants to run Teleport in the mid lane. Ash is an AD carry who try to force the enemy mid laner to run cleanse. If you don't do it, obviously you're very open to get an arrow in your face and then the teamfight starts and you die instantly. That's where Tahm Kench comes in once again. So we might actually see the Skarner pull back that Tahm Kench when he's eating Koro or Prey and then kill both of them.
Yeah, I think that's honestly the idea they're going for, but that gets blocked a little bit by the Veigar pick because if Koro is very patient with his event horizon, he can basically wait for Skarner to run in, and even if you pull him for a suppress, you're still trapping him in there as far as being able to get out of the cage. This has been his pick against Riven.
A challenge has been issued, and Riven is the answer. We all wanted this matchup to happen, and there's split opinions on who should win when it comes to players and when it comes to champions.
There's been a perception in this world that it hasn't been about 1v1s or out playing each other in lane. That is what the entire top lane has been about here at Worlds, especially in Fiora and Riven matchups, because it completely depends on the mind games between Riposte and the two CCs that Riven has to throw out. That is it. Not to mention the jungler pressure, the rest of the other pressure, but we will most likely see a solo kill with these two guys in this game.
Especially also because we're seeing two junglers who prefer to not be too active before that level 6 mark anyway, especially the Skana on the side of Fnatic. So we might not get a whole lot of help for Huni up in that top lane. He's on his own. I'm more looking at Fnatic with this 2v2 lane on the bottom side, the Ashe into the Kalista, heavy CC lane. You run Teleport now on Febivan as well. We just talked about how him on control mages, it gives Fnatic more ways of playing outside of just we gotta go and assassinate people all the time and we have to play super aggressive. They have late game insurance now as well. I'm looking for them to also try and make some plays around this bottom lane once Huni gets rolling.
Well, let's see if Huni can get rolling.
If he gets rolling, I think.
The Riven versus Fiora matchup has happened once before, and it was Huni's Riven that was victorious. Will that hold true against Smeb's Fiora, which is significantly stronger
it was against
than
KOO.
His previous opponent?
And KOO misplayed that matchup so badly already from level 2. Smeb won't make the same mistake.
Let's find out as we load up for game 2. The hope of Europe and the Western LCS, Fnatic on the red side against Korea's KOO Tigers. Majin Buu's been swapped out. The golden god of Zac. And Rainover is going to be playing around these crystal spires. Let's see how well Fnatic handle themselves, because this is a jungler we've not seen in Europe since Diamond ran it a very, very, very long time ago.
Even before it got changed. Honestly, Rainover's put in a lot of practice on Skarner. I was one of his main champions in Korean solo queue, and it's interesting that he falls back onto the Skarner instead of the Olaf, when Olaf would have been able to run through the Veigar stuns. But I do like the idea against the Tahm Kench of still punishing him after he gobbles up an AD carry. This game is really fascinating right now. I also think it's super bold that Febiven has gone teleport against the Veigar, because if he eats an Event Horizon stun, he is completely dead. Lot to go on this game.
Well, it's one of these problems for Nazir, and you have. I look at it this way: when it comes to late game, would he stay alive anyway if he ran like barrier heal? No, he would have to run cleanse then against KOO, and I think that is an okay option. But right now, what Fnatic is aiming to do is trying to match that global pressure KOO brought in game 1 and say, you know what, that was a big problem. Let's try and fix it.
I want to see how Reckless handles himself with that Hawk shot. Something that Prey has shown when he does play Ashe is proficiency not only with landing the Enchanted Crystal Arrow almost perfectly, but also keeping track of his opponent's jungler. So let's see how Reckless makes use of that ability once he ranks it up.
I want to see what Huni and Arena was doing as well. They just took a camp together. They give level 2 to Huni. Normally what happens is you go down and give a few hits to the red buff, but you make sure that Huni doesn't take too much damage, because you want him to run into the top lane. You don't want him to recall and use his teleport, because what's going to happen now, you can see Smeb is doing exactly the same on the bottom side. They should save that TP. So in case the enemy top lane had used his to make sure the jungler got a better start, had to use a potion less, you had that massive TP advantage for more potions and so on later on, which is very important. So both top laners are being set up for success right now with this start.
And neither of these junglers are going to be doing an early game gank. That much is for certain. We did see some teams before Worlds would actually sacrifice others so the jungler could have a faster item spike, go invade the enemy jungler, but with this specific matchup of champions, it's the smart play to give your top laners the edge.
But it's such a fascinating one-on-one, because so many small things will be super important. One thing is that when Smep activates his E, he gets that slow on the first attack and then the crit on the second one. The first slow even reduces attack speed. So it's very hard for Riven to do Q, auto-attack, Q, auto-attack, Q. It turns into basically just spamming Qs right now, because your attack speed slows so much, so it's very hard to trade one-on-one. Also, the riposte against the Riven. If Riven goes for the third Q, the very long animation,
it's almost always
riposte. It's so easy to riposte for Smeb, then he wins the trade. So a lot of Riven players won't even use that third one, and they're just like, use two and then bounce out. So it's very, very tricky between these two guys.
Huni's already falling behind. He's used that potion. Every time we look up, Smeb is finding a way to hit that vital. Keep the sustain up. Saying even in relevant on farm, but Huni's wave will push away from him in the not too distant future. And let's see how Huni plays it. We can see the Rainover already making his way towards the top lane.
There's a chance Huni... Ooh, that was a nice Q3 by Huni. There's a chance he has to use a teleport early in this lane, or he needs early jungle pressure. If a counter gank were to arrive at this moment, if Rainover actually does attempt this, it could be disastrous. This is kind of a Hojin special. Smash is up early, he gets into the lane brush, and he waits there for a minute. And waits for the counter gank. But because of the way the recalls are coming in, I think Smeb called him off.
So we do see though in the mid lane why Fibbon wanted this Azir. He wants to constantly try and push in this mid lane over and over and over. We looked at him as a better mid laner than Koro, at least in the laning phase. And that's what he's going to try and take advantage of. But bottom lane as well, when there's a time Kench, it turns into a farm lane. It's very, very difficult to make any aggressive plays because he will just eat that AD carry or he will be super tanky himself, so you can't really kill anyone.
Wow, it's gonna be a farm lane you talked about. Very small advantage for Reckless. Hojin is gonna pick a fight with Rainover over this Crystal Spire, charge the slingshot, and Rainover says, nope, that one is mine, and will reclaim it.
Skarner is very strong when he gets close to you.
Yes.
That is a fact of this game.
That was one of the things with how you can invade in if your mid laner is pushing, because Skarner 1v1, he is strong, especially against a Zac, who's just gonna be like, what, am I gonna blob on you with my E or nothing?
He's already done like half as
great much. Great riposte from Smeb. He will, however, get stunned, and all of a sudden, Huni turns it back around, forcing Smeb to blow his flash.
That's really big, especially since Rainover's already doing the jungle invading. Hojin's gonna have to be fairly careful early on in the matchup.
Again, we see the strategy for Fnatic, always making sure Rainover can play aggressive, has a jungler he can out-duel the enemy with, have a mid laner who's shoving the wave. So it's a good setup right now for Fnatic, but it was the same in game one, even though they were just even faster and had even more aggressive lanes. That was not what won Fnatic the game, because they didn't win.
Nothing.
Funny enough, nothing won in the game. But it wasn't what lost in the game either, it was the bad calls later on.
Now, Huni and Smeb again going toe-to-toe. He's not going to find the follow-up vital. Falling a little bit behind in CS, but the wave is pushing towards him. And luckily some info on Hojin's jungle path means that Huni's got some free time up here.
You know how people used to have, like, best Riven NA? I feel like it's more exciting to watch Fiora versus Riven. They should just have, like, a bracket of Fiora against Riven players. I love this matchup.
Make it a best of three.
He's level 6 here, and they know they have to flash down. But Smeb is also level 6, which makes this super dangerous.
There's a grand challenge available. Kuro TP to middle,
whoa,
as did Febivin, so there's no support elsewhere. Gentlemen,
it's all
first
about the
tower
here.
Dive. Fnatic are 10 for 10 when it comes to securing first bloods. They're looking for number 11. Rainover forced to flash away. Tower shot will not be enough to kill him, nor will...
Rainover's got...
Is it? Look at Kuro, who's coming up through the jungle. Huni still wants to get it. There's going
to
be in so much trouble, and Rainover fires the fracture. That was so, so close.
Just by Huni moving a bit closer to Smeb on the way out, he threatened a potential second dive, and Smeb was like, okay, I can't risk it. And therefore he couldn't kill Rainover, who just snuck by the tower. But that was so risky by Fnatic.
From the look of it, Smeb blocked the right amount of CC, and then Huni wasn't able to combo properly because he was stunned himself, so he couldn't get the quick burst out on Riven. Still keeps a CS advantage. It costs Rainover his jungle edge in order to do that game.
And he's flash down as well. Reckless, probably gonna eat him by Gorilla. No.
Not yet, not quite tasty enough until now.
Close.
Gorilla will get knocked up and knocked back. He's flashing away. Gray health will get popped.
That's
it is decaying. Prey is stacking up those rends onto Yellowstar. Summoner heal's been used, 250 HP. And both flash and exhaust down from Gorilla. Fnatic, they get the 2v2.
Yeah, they burn a lot of summer spells. I actually feel like if Reckless was feeling aggressive, he would have flashed for that kill on Gorilla, but he was afraid of a counter gank. He didn't have eyes completely on Hojin, I'm pretty sure, because with the shield going down, this is also why he saves his flash, just in case.
Well, Reckless sidesteps the elastic slingshot, and he will be able to make it out.
This is what I really like about Reckless and Yellowstar's lane. They know their job in most Fnatic games is being utility AD carry. So flashing forward for a kill, yes, it might look good on paper, you get that one kill for yourself, but it means you can probably get ganked right after, and then Hojin suddenly gets two kills or one kill and a dragon for his team. So it's not really worth it in that sense, and I like that Rex just stays back and even dodges around.
This is actually dangerous. Huni is still up by his turret, and Febivin's stunning himself.
Febivin's in trouble. Rainover's got the blue buff, but now he's been challenged by Smeb, and Huni's a long way away. The challenge has been popped. First blood to Kuro and double buffs.
You have no flash.
Massive for Vhagar to get double buffs. Reignover doesn't have flash, and he can make that play if Huni is with him. Huni has the 1v1 edge, so to speak, on a Smeb, but there is a large mini wave at his turret. You can make that invade on the blue buff if the waves are pushed. Reignover again overreaches and again is punished.
As safe as Reckless and Yellowstar can play in the bottom lane, some of that needs to go over to Reignover soon. Because, yes, he's making some good plays, but too often, he wants too much. And honestly, it's fine sometimes playing simple League of Legends. You don't have to always go in and make that massive outplay, constantly tower dive the enemy team. You can play it fairly safe because you're right now winning both solo lanes. But now you just gave double buff over to the enemy mid laner. That's not going to help Clippervin one bit.
It really will not. And if Huni continues this path forward,
Huni also has no flash. And Zac has amazing gank pass. Let's see if Huni respects this.
Oh, there's so much threat here for Huni.
He's afraid of Reignover potentially sitting in that bush. Normally, a top laner will not be this aggressive with no summoners in pushing out a big wave unless he has his jungler right behind him,
Psych.
Ready to join in.
Thank you, observers. You can see the Hawkshot flying over the Sentinel, giving Fnatic some information throughout the jungle.
Flies through the whole map. When you're in the right position on Ashe, you can shoot it through every single jungle camp. Which kind of, even if you don't see the jungle with it, tells you where the jungler should be.
Process of elimination. And
it's an immensely powerful skill, highly underrated.
Well, we will give it the attention it deserves, Jack.
You know how clairvoyance used to see one spot on the map? It sees the entire enemy jungle on cooldown.
RIP clairvoyance. So 1-0 in terms of kills. Fnatic still hold a minor gold lead, thanks to the CS advantages for both Huni and Febivin. Reignover's got access to his Impale, and his flash is about 15% away from being available.
I'd like to see Fnatic right now get a few pink wards down on the map to set up this Skarner, so he can go in for that one play once he has flash, grab a target, and you can burst him down very effectively, especially with the Riven up on top side. But it's very hard for him to path right now because there's been so many wards from Blue to spot it. He does manage to sneak around up top here. Can make his way into the second one, and now suddenly Smeb is going to be like, I have no jungle help, so I'm not going to push it out like Huni did before, because I'm going to play it safe.
Very early advantages were to Smeb the lower levels, but as Huni has started to scale up, seems to be finding the stuns and dancing around the riposts.
Dangerous counter jungler.
Oh, this could be trouble. Chance of Crystal Arrow is available. Yellow Star's going to say no.
He wants the crown.
It's about sending a message, gentlemen. This is my jungle, my camp, and my gold.
Every single game, Hojin falls really far behind the curve. Yellow Star is a higher level than Hojin right now, even after that Grom steal.
But I'm a believer. Ku Tigers play from behind. It's their style, Jet.
It actually is. This is the way they play League of Legends. It is somehow working.
Perplexing.
In this day and age.
I think perplexing is a great word.
But at the same time, with this team composition, Fjord and Vhagar, and Zac actually is a good late game jungle champion, they're pretty happy with this current set of circumstances.
All right, Huni gonna pick a fight once more with Smeb. And Grand Challenge throws down. Smeb flashes away from the third proc of the Broken Wings. Huni will find a stun, but fails the flash. And Smeb will be smiling with that one.
Remember the solo kill we talked about? That was probably going to happen in this game. It was right there, but it could have been outplayed by Huni. He had his flash when Smeb did not. He dashed towards the wall, but he fail flashed the thickest wall in the game that when the pressure is on, we see players miss. If you have no pressure, you make that flash every single time. But Huni, after losing that game one, makes another mistake in game two.
And again, we keep highlighting how important it is for Fnatic to keep pushing those two solo lanes. Right now, you got to kill for Vhagar in the mid lane because of Reignover's invade on blue buff. You have a kill top lane now for Smeb and Fiora. Ku Tigers is in a way better situation than last game, where they did outplay Fnatic in the later stages of the game. They look to do exactly the same, just not fall as far behind.
Yeah, and we have to see how Fnatic responds to this situation. In the past, Huni has been known to tilt after making a mistake. They already lost the first game, which puts your mental edge on, puts your mentality on a little bit of an edge. Here, failing a flash over the wall in a matchup he should be winning, how much does Huni want to make up for that play right now? Because in the past he has overcompensated and fallen into a giant pit of tilt. But we'll see, they're still close in this game and they still have a composition which can win.
Well, both teams are in a situation where they can't really force any ganks because there have been so little vision in the enemy jungle. So they don't know where, if Skarner's hiding somewhere, if Zac is hiding somewhere to counter gank. There's no teleports available at the moment, so if you want to make a jungle gank, this is the time. But once again, because Reignover got burnt before with the blue buff, he's not been invading since. He needs to get in there now and get a ward down, at least in the opening of Ku Tiger's jungle. Yellowstar's doing the same to try and see, okay, can we spot the jungler and pull off again? Because if Zac shows topside, you can gank that bottom lane. You have double CC, you have an Alistar to tower dive. It's obviously difficult against a Tahm Kench, but it might be one of the plays you can pull off. You can see Hojin sitting ready to counter gank, as we just talked about. He doesn't want to go aggressive because he has no idea of where Reignover is, unless you spot him on that one ward near Raptor.
Well, also, Huni's not giving him the opportunity. So Huni is not trying to make up for the death he just suffered, and instead is playing very passive. But with the range on Zac's Elastic Slingshot, he's only level 7. He spent a lot of time hiding in a brush. How patient is Huni actually in this lane?
Oh, let's take a look. That Slingshot was being charged, but Yellowstar's the man that's in a little bit of trouble. Gorilla's popped that Grey Health Shield. Hojin will get some of the cooldown back. Huni is dancing with death. He'll dash out and still so close. Hojin's
it's
waiting.
Such a patient bait right here, because you would expect him to jump in after that last play. Huni's still suspicious though.
And Huni makes that alive.
Can we just give full credit to Huni in this case here? Normally he would have gone all in for that one-on-one against Smith. I'll get it back, man. I died before. I will get a revenge kill. But here he played it super safe because his own jungle's on the bottom side taking that dragon. So he knows. Close enough.
Good smite from Reignover.
But he knew, okay, there was no backup for him. He just had to sit super far back and wait, let his team make some plays on the bottom side of the map. I still want to see them use this Alistar and Ashe to create a pick.
Needs to get backup eventually, though, because with that play top lane, they do get
for mid lane, then.
There we go.
Yellowstar flashes the baby cage, knocks Kuro into Reignover's waiting hands, and Febiven sends the soldiers for the kill.
The ultimate displacement from behind your mid turret to the middle of the lane. Nothing Kuro can do to stop that one. Good counterplay by Fnatic.
They did lose their tower top while securing middle, and Huni's gonna get funneled that big wave.
But this is one of their plays Fnatic could make away from Huni. That's again, when Fnatic run compositions where they can make plays on the bottom side, they tend to not rely 100% on Huni snowballing his lane. So even if he does fall behind, you can make a play elsewhere. They had controlling bottom side because Zac was sitting top. Great invade in. Very little you could do as a mid laner when they're coming between two towers and knocking you so far back into the lane. You can't just abandon that, because then you will lose tower anyway. So Koro left in an impossible situation. Fnatic gets at least a tower.
Well, still keeping themselves relevant as far as Fnatic are concerned. They got that first dragon as well, so it'll give them a little bit of an edge as the game continues to progress. And Reckless was left alone in that mid lane. Praying Gorilla shoved the wave up, but Reckless has played far enough back to not be a threat of anything else. His tower only lost 10% of its hit points, so starting to see the Ashe build up towards an Infinity. It's starting to slowly gain more and more strength.
And honestly, I want to see Fnatic continue to play around this bottom side of the map. Zac is not going to duel the Skarner in the one-on-one. Alistar is a very safe support to invade with as well because of his ulti, his natural tankiness, obviously. So you can go into this bottom side jungle of Ku Tigers and take control of it. Meaning that Koro, sitting on his Vega in mid lane with no tier 1 tower now, he has to sit a tier 2 tower and wait for minions. That gives full mid control for Fnatic, and then you can set up a dive on the bottom side.
And I will also say, the emphasis is on Fnatic to make a play. Because Ku Tigers, they have a game plan. We're pretty sure how they're going to execute it. Smeb is going to be split pushing. They're going to try and group with the rest of the team. And the siege potential with Vegar is awesome. But Fnatic has picked Huni. If he can somehow outplay Smeb, he can block that. When they group up as a team, when Koop groups up as a team, Fnatic will try and initiate with an Ashe Arrow. It is going to be Koop kind of executing their game plan and making Fnatic make the play, in which Koop has been able to punish in the past. It will be more on Fnatic's execution, in my opinion.
I really like this from Reignover, getting into that jungle now, plays towards Febiven. Gonna have to be careful, he's getting out for now.
Wow, Febiven makes it out, and they commit Kuro's flash, as well as the Abyssal Void. That was a lot.
It was a five-man gank, and a flash on their most priority member in teamfights. That was way too much. This is kind of the reason Koo doesn't make plays very often.
And this exact same thing happened against KT Rolster, where Koo invested so much, but it didn't work out.
I just really like Fnatic's focus on this bottom side. I know I keep repeating it.
It's because they haven't done it a lot.
They see the gank happening, and also what happens here is Febiven had already killed the wave all the way down to the tier 2 tower of Ku Tigers, so even though he was forced out of the lane, there's no minions for Ku Tigers to just push and take mid tower. They'd be like, oh, the minion's already dead. Well, we're not going to get anything dead to run out, end up losing everything. Fnatic had control of the side. They spotted happening. And this control Fnatic reminds me more of how SK Telecom likes to play against KOO Titans. It's not that, oh, let's 5-on-5, just randomly tower dive and go super crazy all the time. No, we're gonna try and match some of the things KOO Tigers do well. We just remove the mistakes, because KOO Tigers plays around you making mistakes and then punishing you. If you play like this, it's very hard for them to do that.
Let's see if they can keep it up, though.
Yeah, and the biggest example of that is Huni suffering the first blood death, but then staying...
And tilt further.
Right? He has not tilted at all here. I also like his build path this game, because his previous games on Riven, he didn't go Tiamat. He instead went for Bloodburster for some of the survivability. But it's so much more important to be able to have that quick burst of damage against someone who can riposte in your combos, and I love the iteration.
And the playing around bot lane will now make it top lane.
Hojin
and Reckless
is
moved
set up.
Hojin
is absolutely set up for this play.
They did chase him out the jungle though, so Rainover and Yellowstar will be aware.
How many legs does Skarner have?
This one, none. It's
this one, none.
Tank
okay, that's why he doesn't have boots. Okay, that makes sense now for Rainover. The way I look at Skarner is he's a champion who needs mobility. He needs movement speed.
That was a joke.
It was. I'm sorry. Yeah.
See, it caught me off guard because I didn't know you could make jokes, Fisher.
I didn't know either.
Thank you. That was fantastically rewarded. Now I get why Freak does it all the time.
Yeah.
So
still, get some boots, man.
Yeah. I think tank boots is the right way to go. I actually want him to build Mercury Treads during this game, because he will be having to run through Event Horizons at some point during this game, and the Magic Resistance is actually one of his most stacked resources. I think if Fiora tries to kill him, he'll have an opportunity to ult Fiora and instead pull that in, so I think Smeb's going to keep his fair distance from Rainover. I think Mercury Treads should be his next item.
Teleports are up for all four players that currently have it available, and Reckless, hang about in that bush for a little while longer. That top outer turret for KOO is very, very low on HP. And things are just starting to feel a little edgy and nervous up here.
Well,
still, Hojin is reading the situation correct. He's always nearby. Same in the last game. So when that massive gank could happen, he's waiting.
And KOO has the setup with the double teleport. So they're pushing their mid and bottom lane, and they want to teleport. This time, though, Fnatic also has the double teleport. And they recognize not to dive under the turret for this play. Instead, they're just playing it patiently and trying to punish Hojin for waiting for the aggression.
Double warding trinkets for both Huni and Rainover as well, upgraded already. We've seen them move into KOO's jungle to place wards multiple times. Reckless and Yellow, they really want to get this last tower. It's a couple of hits away, but this is quite risky. Gorilla's being chunked and Frey's going forward. Teleport's coming in here for KOO Tigers as Yellowstar throws up the Unbreakable. Reckless will find the Ash Arrow onto Kuro, but it will not be enough. Two members of Fnatic down. At the cost of two teleports for KOO, and KOO are not stopping.
Credit to KOO there for turning aggressive, not reacting to Fnatic in that sense. Fnatic then had to react with both teleports, so a completely lost play for Fnatic. KOO gets the big play by catching out Reckless and Yellowstar.
One of the very annoying things to play against double teleport.
It's also Vhagar, you gotta be careful under these turrets.
Or you can stun them up and maybe kill Rainover.
Rainover's down! Kuro gets the kill and will secure another tower.
One of the problems when playing against double teleport is you don't know how many guys it's going to turn up. You see the animation. I'm not sure if Fnatic were trying to say, hey, we can maybe counter teleport here, because there's still two flashes up for Reckless and Yellowstar. They stayed around for a long time. Yellowstar maybe was just to sacrifice himself, saying he was going to get slowed down anyway. But then suddenly two guys appear, both Smeb and Foro, and Fnatic is too late to the party. Two kills and a tower.
And once again, KOO punish Fnatic to regain the lead.
Yeah, let's see again what happens.
They ping Skarner, and then they know to go aggressive here, because honestly, it's completely on the double TP coordination. They thought it would be one. It was actually two. Reckless got the Ash Arrow. The second teleport cancels the first teleport's animation, which is why Reckless didn't have the right timing on Smeb jumping in, and it's actually why the Ash Arrow didn't hit. So really, the double teleport on the same ward is my favorite use of the double teleport, and it works out for me.
We'll give them another tower. 5-1, but Fnatic, you have to praise farming from Huni and Febiven, keeping gold very, very even. 300 difference between the top laners, 100 difference between mid laners, and that was a little close again, but Smite secures it.
We've seen this one before. Frey tries to steal it. Doesn't have the greatest amount of damage to do his low amount of AD, though, when it comes to finding away that spear. Meanwhile, though, Fnatic, once again, are in a situation where they really want to try and pick someone off, but because you're against double teleport and a Tahm Kench, it becomes almost impossible, because there's so many ways for KOO Tigers to buy time and then counter gank it. So even though Fnatic has great tools to find that one pick, they haven't been able to use it, and they were just waiting almost for Two Tigers to make an aggressive play. Which is funny enough, something Two Tigers have done before when they're pushed all the way back. They try and go for a double TP to turn it around and buy some time.
This time it works, and for Fnatic, that flawless style of play comes into a little bit of question. It wasn't exactly a game-changing move, but Fnatic are still showing they really want this last outer turret. They move four people up towards the top, and they've got a lot of vision around Barry.
And something that is really in the favor of Crew Tigers is the fact that Crow is at plus 191 on his stacking of ability power, and he's currently sitting at 600 AP. Pretty soon, he's going to be able to press two buttons on Febivend and kill him dead.
This is in trouble, Rain. Over in Yellowstar, they've got caught out. Unbreakable Will's being used, and Hojin is trying to bounce all up in Reckless's face. Smev is down, but look at Hootie. He gets obliterated by Kuro. Rain over's in trouble. Baron Pit is where Yellowstar's trying to escape. He's forced to flash over the wall. 5v2 now. Baron is alive and may be able to get some hits down onto Smith and Hojin. Fate's Call will be thrown onto Febivend, and Febivend finds the kill, but the Event Horizon locks him in place, and Prey will shut him down. Another sacrifice to stop Baron, but Fnatic again caught out of position.
Kuro 100% to zeroed Hootie there. And he doesn't have Void Staff yet. Mind you, Hootie has gone for cooldown boots, so if he gets hit by an Event Horizon, he has signed his own death certificate because it will be crushed there by the Vigar. It's a flank fight. I think Fnatic was actually pretty happy with this one. They didn't have vision on the Vigar, and also he didn't see that Event Horizon, otherwise he wouldn't have walked into it. Boom, instantly killed. That then turns into a 4v5, and then it's actually on.
Sure.
It's on Febivend at this point,
yeah.
To salvage.
Very, very classic situation though, where you're running to a team fight and you're looking at the fight and not your own character. So even if something happens around you, you don't have the time to dodge it. Get stunned, ends up dying for it. But really, a Vigar who got to just sit and farm and farm and farm. Jad, you talked about it just before. He's like 616 AP. He got ranked to ulti as well. So Kuro has hit the point where he can one-shot basically everyone on the side of Fnatic.
This is how you push. This is what they want to be able to do this game. It forces Fnatic into having to initiate, and they have two QSSs as well already.
It's so much more difficult for Fnatic when Rainover cannot even pull somebody in. Luckily, for Fnatic, Gorilla on that Tom Kench does not have it yet, but we've seen supports pick up QSSs in the past.
I think it's good on Tom Kench. If it is in a situation where you feel like you're going to get CC so you can't save a carry, I think QSS is perfectly fine to build on him, but Fnatic, again, they keep looking for that one pick. But because Tom Kench is also in the game, if it's not landed on him, he will eat that guy. And that guy will then get out.
So KOO secure themselves another tower. Hojin is charging up the slingshot. Yellowstar's gone forward. Reckless is in trouble. He's got no flash, but he's managed to back away. The Dark Matter drops and tags Fnatic. Arise the Sun Disc is what Febivend yells. There's something to fall back to, but Smeb is trying to fight Hootie on the back line. Gorilla's Grey Health will keep him alive a little while longer, long enough to take out Reckless. Hootie looks for one back, doesn't find it. Double kill for Prey as Hootie gets one on the way out onto Kuro. 2 for 3.
That fight was all started because of preemptive usage of Event Horizon. That is a spell pretty much everyone is playing around in this matchup. Kuro used it. It didn't hit anyone. In the instant it expired, Fnatic decided to jump in for the fight. That was a really back-and-forth fight, and Febivend nearly peeled off as much as he could for Fnatic. And because he died, basically while channeling his last Soldier auto-attack, it turned what could have been four deaths on KOO's side to a one fight.
You also just see how Fnatic always trying to focus one Tiger together with the Ashe, with the Azir. But then what's going to happen is Gorilla is going to stay so far forward, nobody wants to hit him because he's just an annoying Tom Kench up in the front line. So he eats Hojin, make sure he doesn't die in the start of the fight, and gets picked up by Prey. And notice how well they coordinate this one. There's two carries from Fnatic standing next to each other, down on the bottom and just outside of your screen. Smith obviously playing well on top, but those two carries get locked up. Again, it's Gorilla in the front line, making sure his carries can get in there, deal the damage they need to win the fight for his team. And it's so difficult for Fnatic to kill this frontline because it's a Zac with his passive and it's a Tom Kench.
For Fnatic, keep running out of options. Great play by Smebs Fiora, 1-0-8. Managed to riposte so much damage in that previous fight. KOO've got control of the Baron Pit. They've got wards all around and teleport advantage to Fnatic as Hootie has his, whereas Smeb does not. That's why Hootie's probably pushing out that bottom line.
Yeah,
Yeah, still only 4 kills being able to get manufactured by Fnatic. KOO is doing a much better job this game of maintaining their early game, and now they get to absolutely execute their strategy, especially once Kuro gets to Void Staff. I think Fnatic's window will close.
Kuni probably has to get like a Hexstringer or something that maybe could save him. If he gets his own shield and a Hexstringer proc to avoid getting one shot by Kuro, otherwise he will have no impact in this fight.
Well, Hawkshot sees it.
They're going in for Fnatic. It might be the chance for him to turn around.
Crystal Arrow does connect onto Smeb. The Event Horizon will lock Fnatic up. They've got Baron.
Time to fight.
They've got Baron indeed. Teleport's being channeled by Huni and Fnatic. They need to get something back. Yellowstar flashes forward, gets the knockup, but Hoshin jumps back in. The Event Horizon's come back off cooldown and has once again locked Fnatic out. Yellowstar's already down, as is Huni. KOO are looking for a rampage. Gorilla jumps forward. He manages to find another as Smeb's running down Feathervin. Fnatic get aced and lose the Baron.
And we see the same things again. Fnatic trying to kill the front line, Tahm, Kench, and of course the Zac. They end up helping each other. Gorilla eats, Hojin spits him out, and then Smeb also in these fights.
Smeb is so good.
He's so good in team
fights. He is waiting exactly for the moment where he is most vulnerable, and then he is stopping the damage. That's the Master Fiora players are the ones who can do this. Massive death timers off Fnatic. That was the trigger Fnatic had to pull. They didn't have a better ward for Huni to jump in on, and KOO knew it. So KOO took that fight exactly as Fnatic was going to have to react, and they make it work.
Fnatic is losing the war when it comes to the carry sitting in the backline dealing damage, because against the Vega, who can just one-shot these targets and has this massive AoE CC stun. At the same time, Huni is not able to find a flank on the Riven. That's the way you can get in and kill the Vega or kill the Kalista. He's not able to do it. Again, let's just ignore the fact that Tahm Kench could potentially even save whatever carry that is and stop it from happening. So KOO Tigers pick and ban phase. First picking that for Gorilla, banning out junglers and so on. Was really, really smart. Notice again in the fight, Fnatic, they have to sit back here and hit the front line over and over. No ward for Huni to teleport to flank. So now KOO Tigers is in the perfect situation. As long as Prey doesn't get knocked back and dies here, Hojin takes the damage. Gorilla is going to eat him so he doesn't die. Okay, again, buy more time. Riposte coming in for Smeb at a beautiful time. And we just have Kuro sitting on full HP still, picking whatever targets he wants, throw it back in Gorilla when needed, and you have that massive CC coming.
They get themselves two inhibitors, the Baron, their first dragon of the game, and KOO Tigers are in a commanding position to close this game out. Smeb got a GA picked up, but he riposte the Skarner ultimate in the mid lane earlier. He riposte a ton of damage in the Baron pit. And KOO Tigers are now barreling down the last remaining inhibitor. Event Horizon should make this easy as pie. Yep. And the tower's already down.
There's also no flash on Yellowstar's Alistar to find the right initiation. They're trying to poke as much as possible. Honestly, if KOO rushes this, it's Fnatic's only real chance. KOO should be super patient here. Sundisk burned, that was going to be used by Febben if the dive were to happen. Now KOO's just going to smartly set up the split push with Smeb. And if that Event Horizon catches a single person, the game is over. The game may be over even if that doesn't happen.
Well, it certainly seems to be that case. Super Minions already pushing towards the Nexus turrets with the help of Smeb. Huni, wow, he just gets chunked down. He's going to throw out the QSS and it's going to have broken wings away. But Smeb has got so much damage. The Sundisk is out. The last remaining inhibitor is being dropped. Fnatic are on their last legs. Their backs cannot get further up against the wall.
Yeah, I think that was actually a missed opportunity. The riposte was burned by Smeb and Rainover was in flashed alt range. He might have been able to get at least one kill and stop the push. Huni could have died there as well. Oh, Fnatic, three waves of super minions that KOO is patiently trying to push in. But Baron is down, so maybe it relands.
Ever the optimist, Jets. This is just a matter of time until
like
KOO knocked down these towers. Hojin is going to threaten with the elastic slingshot. Huni gets away from the Event Horizon, but Nexus turret number one is being dropped. Hojin doesn't even need to jump in. Reckless has got the enchanted crystal arrow. He's not thrown it yet. Huni's looking for Kuro, and he finds him, but at the cost of his own life. The Emperor's Divide will throw KOO backwards, and Prey's being tagged by the soldiers. Another Conquering Sands needs to get sent out. A nom 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 as Gorilla eats Smeb. Fiora's gonna get away. No GA popped, and Fnatic, they stand to fight another day with one Nexus turret remaining.
And you said it was over, Quickshot.
You're the optimist, I'm the pessimist. It's how we balance out.
Yeah, it's still heavily in favor of KOO Tigers. Three inhibitors down is something you almost never come back from. Although Fnatic did come back from three inhibitors down against AHQ
in the group stage. Slightly different set of circumstances, though, to Fischio.
Yeah. I mean, Febiman has done it before. He's trying his best to do it again, but this fight really was Kuni finally getting a flash onto one of the carries from Ku Tigers. Gorilla wasn't nearby to save Koro, and he ends up dying, and therefore they trade one for one. Now that flash is gone for Fnatic, and they're still in this situation where super minions are coming every single lane.
Round two approaching. Ku looking to go up 2-0. This would be so huge for them.
This is why you bring in Froggen, though, if you're Fnatic. He was like, just kill these minions, man. Just farm.
The emergency sub. That is your only way. Oh, Huni.
Huni's in so much trouble. He's got no flash either. Valor will give some distance, but Kuro isn't going to channel the Event Horizon until now. Febiven's caught out, and he's been bounced on by Hojin. Impale's been used, and Fnatic have managed to find prey. Now Gorilla's too far forward. Kuro's going to fall. Huni's got himself a double kill. Gorilla's trying to run away. Rainover is going to get the movement speed from his W and try to chase him down. Fnatic have held strong one more time.
Hawk shots him.
Rainover wants to get him. Gotta land the skill shot.
Well, it's gonna put that chilling smite down. Rainover's gonna carry on chasing with the crystalline exoskeleton.
Oh,
longest chase ever.
He lives.
And Gorilla gets out.
Fnatic again, though. Ku Tigers move close. They want to kill that last Nexus turret. And Fnatic get a few more kills again onto the carries of the Ku Tigers. So the beautiful team fighting where they were sitting so far back and making it impossible for Fnatic to kill them. Twice in a row now. Didn't work for Ku Tigers.
Ku Tigers make a series of mistakes there. I think they were impatient. They did not need to fight that as early as possible. Azir is actually the best champion in the game at clearing three ways of super minions because his soldiers can hit so many of them at once. But even then, three waves of super minions in 32 minutes should take all of Febiven's time, and if you're just waiting until he's focusing the super minions, you can then find the fight. But Ku pushed up a little bit too far, twice in a row,
and
now have to wait on the next Baron.
Fnatic optimize the farming coming in with three lanes pushing. You can see every single member for Fnatic is ahead in farm, even Yellowstone. Is it enough, though, for Fnatic to move out now? They have to win this fight around the Baron, where they're walking into a river with zero vision from
Hawk
the side
shot
of Fnatic.
Is the only tool that they can use.
And Koro can one-shot basically everyone.
Kuro's got plus 300 AP at this stage. His Primordial Burst deals 1,500 damage before factoring in your opponent's AP.
Yeah.
Hawkshot number one, fired. Hawkshot number two, fired as well.
Kuro needs to have a fight where he's able to use his spells. If that happens, I think Ku gets the game. Fnatic is going to try and stop that from happening, though. Yeah. Ku actually pretty low from the Baron start. Will Fnatic actually turn on Baron?
Teleports come in here
for
Huni.
They have to because the super's in the other lane.
They're going to see how long can they time. Play this out. Kuro and Smip do not have TPs. Baron has now been started by Fnatic. They're trying to chunk it down. It's about two-thirds HP. Ku are looking to re-engage. The Asho is available. Baron secured by Fnatic. And Hojin's locked out. They've caught Smip. Smip's GA has been popped. Rainover and Huni trying to run the distance. They're trying to interfere. Smip is down. Shut down by Febiven. Event Horizon will stop this fight. One for one and Baron to Fnatic.
Are you kidding me? Fnatic pulls out a miraculous fight, three numbers down, and they save their last Nexus turret.
Ku Tigers tried to just wait and wait and wait for the super minions to take down the Nexus turret, but Fnatic rushed the Baron, got it as well, forced the fight. Ku Tigers were once again not able to properly set up their defense with this big front line because they have to rush into Fnatic. Two dragons for two. That's not going to be the big thing in this game, at least not for the next 20 minutes.
It is now a winnable game for Fnatic. Obviously, they have no base left, but their inhibitors are back up, so if they do not lose another fight, their base is never fully reached. This is the moment where Ku needs to settle and go back to the split push, but this fight, let's go over it.
So let's see again what Ku Tigers are trying to do. They get forced back very fast. Smith is on his own now against two carries of Fnatic and goes down. Yellowstar even going to go in to try and help. And is now Rainover and Huni creating a frontline for Fnatic that is taking up all the time of the carries.
And poor Event Horizons by Kuro. He needs that spell to zone the team fights, but instead, Smeb is isolating himself against two other carries, and then he actually lost his GA within that fight.
There's still no defensive item for Reckless, though, when it comes to avoiding getting one shot by Vega. So one mistake from him in a fight, and he's dead.
Hoonies trying to catch that Crystalline Spire, does get it. Teleport's available for KOO in a few seconds. Thriller almost gets chunked out by those Sand Soldiers. Will that be enough for the tower? It yep. looks like it. A Fnatic will take their fourth tower of the game at 39 minutes. Now, there's no margin for error. Not only are we 40 minutes in with no base to fall back to, Smeb and Kuro can TP. If anything goes well, there's not deep wards. We've got to remember.
Breakfast is getting flashed very, very soon. Again, he has the BT. That's his only defense, but that's not enough against these two carries yep. who wants to try and kill him. So he needs that flash ready. He needs to be so far back that he can't hit the tower because of the zoning from Vhagar.
There is no zonies and no cleanse on Febavend. So if Kuro flashes, Qs, and ults, Febavend dies if those spells land. They have no margin for error on these pushes.
Fnatic have not had a margin at all. Smeb's off on the side, dancing with death in front of Rainover. Tower continues to get chunked out by those double. Oh. Can I take it back? They're dead.
Tower's not being chunked. He is at 1,062 ability power as of now on Vhagar, and it will only get higher. Plus 311 on his Baleful Strike so far.
Minion Wave down in the bottom lane, though, has no one to answer it. Thank you, Observers, and Fnatic will still get some cross-map pressure.
Smeb is on his way. So there's two low towers now that Fnatic might be able to get in the next push, but Baron should be gone. So we kind of reset once again. We have that situation where Fnatic is looking to win two or three fights to make sure they can then close out the game, where KOO Tigers is waiting for that one team fight.
Right. I also think it depends very heavily on the location of the fight right now.
Oh, for sure, and how many dies.
If the line of scrimmage stays where it's at, because if we look at the concentration of wards, that tell us... The locations of the wards tell us where the game is being played. And currently the game is actually being played in KOO territory, which is miraculous. So if that's where the next fight happens within the vision of wards, which is what usually happens, one team fight for Fnatic does also win the game on their side.
Still just have to keep looking at two carries from Fnatic with no way of avoiding getting one shot by Coral. Vhagar is one of the few champs with two abilities with 1.0 AP ratio.
The QSS and the zonies this time, yeah. But if they can at least delay the usage of his spell, so he can't combo
in this matchup.
Could Trundomir win?
Oh, this is a question for the ages and one that we'll debate at a later date.
Yeah, Trundomir can always do that.
A minute and 40 seconds until Dragon respawns. The goal difference is now swung to the point that it is completely even. One more mistake from either squad could be game-changing. For KOO, it's the matter of being one nexus away from a finals berth, and for Fnatic, it's just evening out the series. So the pressure is definitely on Fnatic, a hometown squad. Crowd is at their back.
That's a
also
dangerous
adds weight.
I absolutely agree, Quickshot. The gravity of this situation is massive. Spectre's Cal completed. Febavend close to Zhonya's Hourglass, but it's not a Banshee's Veil and it's not a Zhonya's. Those are the items Fnatic actually needs to have an offensive position in this game. But at the same time, they've won many team fights in a row without those items.
KOO Tigers definitely overextended with their carries. Sure, they've been talking about that for the last 5 minutes now. How are we going to approach the next team fight? Are we going to wait for Baron? Make that same play we tried to make before, where we forced Fnatic to walk in at the river, and this Event Horizon can basically almost cover the entire river placed by Korra and zone out the team, and then we take the Baron that way. The only reason they waited last time was because they had the super minions pushing on the bottom side. They thought they could take down a Nexus turret, and then Fnatic pulled the trigger and went straight for Baron.
Gentlemen, Hourglass completed for Febavend. Wards in the mid lane behind Fnatic, and Fnatic wards in the river if KOO decide to go for Dragon. But with Dragon in 20, Baron in 40, that is the objective. And again, if Fnatic are out of position, they can bounce back.
Yeah, KOO's two wards within the base of Fnatic are awesome right here. But this positioning,
This is scary.
Lead for some fights. Event Horizon down, but it's in a nice zone, so Fnatic can actually push through it. They need to come with a pink ward in their base or something to stop this flank, because if Fnatic goes in for the Baron here, there's a chance Smeb actually just teleports in and kills all three inhibitors. They don't even need Kuro to go in. Smeb just has to find Fnatic in a committed place, and because how quickly Fjord can kill inhibitors, he'll get all three.
I don't think there's ever been a team that has had this many dances with Nexuses as Fnatic.
I want to see in this team fight here, if Yellowstar says, I'm going to one-on-one Kuro, because we might not be able to kill him with QSS and Hourglass, but if Alistar can headbutt him away, keep him busy, way back, save his own carry, that might be enough. They're going in now.
Febbervin's in trouble, he's been bounced up, exhausted, and he's down! That's the last hope for Fnatic! Reynover's running away, as Smeb zoning him. Reckless, he's got his shield popped. Up as Yellowstar kicks him away. Reckless goes down. Double kill for Prey. Reynover and Hooney trying. To get out, and Smim still alive. The riposte will apply the slow. The knock up from Hojin Zach. And with Fnatic's base exposed, KOO Tigers find themselves another kill. Killing spree for Prey, and they're going for the Nexus.
So much has happened in these first two games, but both games are ultimately decided with Febbervin dying in a fight without doing damage. He has played his heart out to keep them in these games, but he hasn't had quite enough, and this will be KOO up going 2-0.
The deficit was too big, and KOO Tigers are 2-0 against Fnatic.
Wow. This game, we saw a different strategy from Fnatic. They didn't want to try and go all in for these aggressive early plays. They ran teleport in the mid lane. The problem is, they're still making too many of these mistakes in the early game where KOO Tigers punish them, get one, two kills for it, and keep delaying the game and get past that early stage for themselves.
This was a game where Fnatic almost came back from having three inhibitors down. The emotional roller coaster that just happened can be absolutely devastating. Everyone who plays League of Legends knows losing is one thing, but almost having a miraculous comeback fall short is perhaps the most gut-wrenching thing that can happen to you.
And we just got to see KOO Tigers had 5-6 minutes to talk. How are we going to play this team fight? What is going wrong? They realize, okay, Febbervin has an Hourglass. Sure, that's fine. But as long as we can land a CC, he can't use it. And then you just saw Kuro just flash forward all team straight away and kill him with the rest of his team. And that's how you win the fight for the KOO Tigers. Basically, their composition in the late game had a lot of different ways they could play out these fights. A lot easier for them to one-shot a carry on the side of Fnatic compared to the other way around.
Yeah.
And just a smart team-fighting composition for the KOO Tigers. And again, they don't get punished early because Fnatic makes two great moves and then two bad moves. And we keep going like this, and that keeps the gold even.
So I feel like KOO Tigers was actually winning the early game in a lot of ways. They made a lot of the smart moves in the early game, which I think gave them an edge. They're up something like 12-4, and they even made aggressive teleport plays in the early and mid-game and started getting them that lead. And then with that one play, they turned on their split-pushing like grind game, and they just destroyed. But then they made a lot of really big mistakes in the late game, which was the opposite of what we'd seen before. This series could actually be 2-0 in either direction, which that's honestly what Fnatic needs to remember, and it's what KOO needs to remember to keep them focused.
The thing that is great, it is one of the more competitive series that we have watched thus far. The final team fight, there was no mistakes, though, from the KOO Tigers. Let's pull that up onto your screen.
Yes, please.
And, of course, Hojin on this Zac, engaging from so far away, 0-0-13 at the end of the game.
It's why he picks the Zac. He knows he's going to sacrifice his own early game by picking it, but once we get to these late-game team fights, they're playing around anyway, and they're playing around punishing your mistakes early to mid to get to late-game. It is so, so powerful.
Yeah, and just, you can't have perfect vision control in this area at this stage of the game. Look at the range on that elastic slingshot. And then the instant flash is what's so important, because Febbervin needed to reaction flash that before it landed. That's the only way he stays alive in that situation.
And even then, he's just stuck in the front line in an Hourglass. He gets out and he probably gets stunned by Event Horizon or something. But KOO Tigers, beautiful chaining of the CC. Zac goes in with slingshot, then ulti, then Gorilla gets thrown in, not keeps him up in the air, and then flash forward from Kuro just to kill him. I mean, there's so little you can do at that point, and that's just the composition from the KOO Tigers that have so many more ways of playing late-game teamfights.
So well played. KOO Tigers 2-0 up. And to take a closer look at the entire match, we're going to head to the analyst desk.
Thank you, gentlemen. 2-0 is right, and they're very correct in that this series is much closer than it appears based on the score. I want to go all the way back to the beginning, though. Champion Select, Skarner, is the first thing of many that I want to look at.
I really liked the KOO Tigers draft here. If we take a look, they prioritize that Tahm Kench, take it immediately, and that's going to deny a lot of options for any kind of engage with an Ash Arrow or anything like that. They take the Zac again, obviously very confident in Hojin's ability, maybe not in the early game, but at least to play the team fights. We saw how well he ulted onto Febivin in that last fight. Then the Skarner comes out, and how do they answer it? Veigar. Instantly take that champion because it shuts down everything that Fnatic wants to do. Not only that, they get two early QSSs onto the Veigar and onto the Kalista, but just the way they set up team fights, okay, the arrow comes in. Event Horizon goes down. There's no follow-up. You can't get in there with a Skarner. Too many QSSs. There were so many ways for KOO to play the team fights and very limited engage options from Fnatic.
Yeah, I agree here, Monte Cristo, on the engage, especially if you look at that Azir pick second rotation on purple side. So very early pick. Arguably, your strongest member there is Febivin, so you really want to get him a matchup. But in these team fights, he really couldn't, or Fnatic Water couldn't play the way Azir's supposed to be playing, which is kite, you know, zone control around objectives, let people come to you and just face the wrath of those soldiers. But every time Fnatic engaged, Febivin really couldn't contribute much in the fights until the later parts, but then they were already lost. So they're playing a team composition or strategy where they kind of dive into the backline, but KOO denies that entirely with their champ select and does that kind of better on their own. So it was incredibly hard for Fnatic to play out of this. And then in addition to that, KOO just played the mid-game better with their teleports.
Well, I think when you see the Tahm Kench, you're automatically not going to go for a dive pick comp. You already lose instantly because the Tahm Kench just completely screws that up. So I think the Azir pick is fine. I think the way they played around their picks was their undoing. Like, Skarner, like, yeah, argue about that all you want because I don't like it. But with the Ash, yeah, you're not going to use Ash Arrow to engage because you're not going to get your target. The thing is you still can kite with the Azir Ash. You outrange both Veigar and Kalista. The one thing is that what they weren't doing is Riven wants to go in and Skarner wants to go in. And now they're trading, like, the top's going in, and then now it's like a Riven chasing a Kalista compared to a Fiora chasing an Ashe. Like, that sucks. Why don't you just, like, kite back and then Ashe arrow when they overextend? I think they just played the fight just really, really strange and just didn't play it slow enough.
Well, and also, too, KOO, somewhat surprised Fnatic, 21 minutes into the game, KOO flipped things on their head. They went aggressive onto Fnatic, and they were slow to react to this gank in the top lane.
Yeah, that was definitely really the turning point, and we have a replay of that coming up later, as well as we just have a look at the KOO guys here. Yeah, pretty calm and collected, right? And this is where the KOO does it well. They know where Rainover is on the Skarner. They go aggressive, and the teleports come in first, and Jad talked a bit about this as well, double teleport and single ward. Now we see, not Prey, actually, Gorilla bending the bullet here, going around the side there with the Fate Scout. He has actually been doing that fantastically in a lot of these situations where he has multiple men knockups with that Fate's Call, and it's actually sometimes relatively hard to do in the middle of the chaos, so really props to Gorilla there for what he's landing. But KOO is ahead of the play. They're the ones initiating it, they have the full vision, they set the teleports down first, and there was almost no way out for Fnatic there, so lack of proactivity a little bit here on Fnatic and being punished for not getting anything done.
Well, the best part about KOO doing this is it's super unexpected from KOO. They've been playing really slow until the late game, and now when they start this, Fnatic has to instantly respond, and not just respond quickly, but correctly.
Yeah.
So Fnatic's in a really bad spot the second they push up to that tier 2 turret without their jungler, without wards to TP on. So once they get in that spot, regardless if they knew it was happening, they just weren't ready for it at all. So even if they instantly respond, they're already out of position.
Yep. I mean, too, as well, actually, what's interesting is that you mentioned they have to execute properly in that scenario because Yellowstar had a ward. Right, they did TP, they had both TPs available, but that is so much information that needs to be passed and then decided upon so quickly, and they were caught off guard because they'd been the aggressors in the past.
I mean, that's why it's always better to be on the offensive, right? Because you're the one deciding, you already have everything lined up in your brains, and the other team has very little time to react.
Now I want to push ahead to a place where Fnatic was proactive and made a very strong and bold decision. Baron Dance push KOO off of the Baron with super minions pushing in their bot lane against them.
It's a beautiful call.
This was a beautiful call.
Yeah, so we see right here, just taking it, and they are going to actually initiate this fight. So Gorilla just trying to zone right now, but this is pretty greedy of KOO right here. They're going to take a lot of damage. Smeb tanking the Baron at first, probably not the best idea.
Yeah, in this situation, the burden of the outplay is on Fnatic, and look at the cage going down here. This just gives Fnatic a 10-second window, I believe, at this point in the game, Vigar Cage, where they need to make a call. They get the crystal. Cage is about to come up, but they have the zone control. And now, Fnatic's a little scared of what's going to happen. The only play they can make here is do the Baron, but it takes so much guts to make that call here at the World Championship. And then, honestly, KOO should find a way. If people are bunched up like this, place the cage at the entrance somehow. This is a horrible cage here from KOO, because it doesn't really achieve anything you want to do in these fights. And then Fnatic with some fantastic kiting to round out that fight.
Yeah, I think the way the call started off was they actually sent Fiora to the mid lane. So this was a reaction call from Fnatic. And it was a reaction call that looked like they're the ones being proactive, but the whole time they're waiting, like, is anyone mispositioning? Boom, Fiora shows up mid, they take Baron, and it's like, now they're just doing awesome stuff.
One thing I still want to touch on, what I think Fnatic should do better, is just get back to a sidestone on Rainover. Really just get more information with wards. Fnatic in the European LCS thrived by just using wards efficiently and then getting a little extra teleport angles. If you're playing double teleport, the value of that second sidestone definitely goes up. So the more wards you have, the more angles you can make it play, because late game, it's so hard to get behind people. We saw the value of one single, not even a deep ward, lane ward in the top lane that facilitated that play that we had on the replay earlier from KOO. Those are the things you want to be looking for.
Well, it's 2-0 now, but both of these games have been incredibly close. Keep it tuned right here, because our coverage from Brussels continues with Game 3 of Fnatic versus the KOO Tigers. As we go, a reminder that World Championship Summoner icons are only available until the end of the tournament, so be sure to spam those emotes and support your team before they're disabled on November 5th. We'll be right back as Fnatic fight to stay alive, so don't go anywhere.
Smith flashes away from the third proc of the Broken Wings. Hooney will fight, but fails the flash. But Smith is trying to fight Hooney on the back line. Gorilla's great health will keep him alive a little while longer, long enough to take out Reckless. KOO are looking for a Rampage. Gorilla jumps forward. He manages to find another as Smith's running down Febivin. Baron secured by Fnatic, and Hojin's locked out. They've caught Smith. Smith's GA has been popped. Rainover and Hooney trying to run the distance. Reckless has got his shield popped, knocked up as Yellow Star kicks him away. Reckless goes down. Double kill for Prey. And KOO Tigers are 2-0 against Fnatic.
are back here in Brussels and heading into game three of Fnatic versus the KOO Tigers with a spot in the finals hanging in the balance. Now, Fnatic's backs are against the wall, and they have to win every game from here on out if they want to make that move. But I want to talk about someone who's going to do everything in his power to stop them from moving on, Smeb. We didn't talk about him in the post game, but that guy avoiding that early tower dive and his 1v1 play, especially on this Fiora, has just been tremendous throughout the tournament.
I mean, his Riven play was spectacular as well, but coming into this, this is the main thing that I was like, it's like 50-50, but the thing that really tipped my prediction over the edge was thinking about Smeb versus Huni in this matchup. And Smeb has just been so dominant to this point in this series. And we've seen him blind pick Riven. Apparently, Fnatic doesn't have an answer. Now we've seen Huni play Riven. Seems like the KOO Tigers and Smeb do have an answer in Fiora. So where do you go from here?
It's a good question. It's definitely a good question. And that's where we can jump into Champion Select here. Again, back onto the blue side for Fnatic. So they have a little bit of room to play with when it comes to Champion Select. I feel it's time to turn our heads towards Daylor and the coaching staff and say, what are you going to do to set your team up, your players up, in the right place to make the right plays in the game and then come out with a victory?
Well, I mean, the game one, we saw them all in on the early game, taking that Ignite. Game two, they slowed the pace down, but they found themselves at a mid-game deficit. I do think Fnatic did a great job of coming back in an extraordinarily difficult situation, and the KOO Tigers didn't close it out effectively. So now it's like, which one are they going to go for next?
I think Brawley made a great point in our post-game of our last match there, that Fnatic just need to get a cohesive team composition. Yep. They picked two champions that are great at kiting with the Azir and the Ashe, but then, I mean, you went for the all-in, so you can't have the best of both worlds, because then you will get torn apart, especially against a pick like Tahm Kench. Additionally, maybe an early prior on Tahm Kench will definitely be there for Fnatic too, and just get a team composition with an identity, but that isn't as early game oriented. I liked what they brought game one going full on the early game, but I would still like to see at least two teleports, two side stones, and then a composition with a clear identity that Fnatic then can play around its strengths.
I think Fnatic got a more well-rounded comp aside from the Riven pick. I agree. I think the Riven pick for them was they got to play their ego pick. They got to try the 1v1 top, they tried to camp the top, try to get that ahead, and now it didn't work. Now they can reassured, like, we can't win this 1v1 top. This matchup isn't the way we thought. Now we need to go back to picking top laners for comps. And this is their option to go back to that.
And I'm pretty sure we saw Yellowstar ran Ignite last game. That should have been exhaust, especially against that composition. If you can actually dive into the back line with the Yellowstar, just against these lineups that KOO is running, you need the exhaust.
Well, we have ideas what we want to see, but one thing is for certain. It is do or die for Fnatic here. Right now, we're going to head over to the caster booth for the call.
Thank you very much, Dash. 2-0 in favor of the KOO Tigers. Fnatic back on blue side. Last time around, KOO banned out GP, Mord, and Elise. Are we expecting that to stay the same?
Yeah, why change it if you're the KOO Tigers at the moment? It's more on Fnatic. If they want to leave a Tahm Kench open and first pick it, and then ban Rek'Sai themselves, I don't see that happening. I think they will value getting that early jungle pick for Reignover. But then do a mix. You don't have to do Rek'Sai, LeBlanc with Ignite, and like all in on the early game. You can do Rek'Sai and like Azir again, or Victor in the mid lane, a control mage with teleport, and you get early game power and you get some late game power at the same time.
I still think Fnatic should go in for the early game. I think their game one strategy was sound. I think if they execute that better, they can try to pull their way back in the series, because KOO has no need to change their play style, and I think Fnatic should try and play that nearly winning game again.
And that's why I like Azir, especially for Febiwen, because it's one of the champions where he can win that mid lane and push it in and be aggressive, while still have more team fighting power later on. But obviously LeBlanc was left open by the KOO Tigers in the first game because of Gangplank, Mordekaiser, and the Elise ban. But I'm still expecting Fnatic to go for Rek'Sai as the first pick. We see exactly the same bans come in so far for both teams. Lulu would come next for Fnatic, and then Elise, if it is, as in game one.
Nothing changed yet. Let's see if Fnatic agree and they want to go for that early to mid-game team fight, where they were up against it, against Origin in the Summer Split Finals. They ran Rumble and Emmy for similar style. Game ended up going long, but it was that play that got them there. Instead of banning Lulu, they take out Veigar.
Maybe trying to tell KOO Tigers, you need to ban Lulu now and we get Elise first pick, but I think KOO Tigers can still just ban Elise and first pick Fnatic first pick Rek'Sai and then get Lulu themselves.
This is super tricky because now they need to pick between the Rek'Sai or the Lulu. That's a really high valuation they put on that Veigar.
But it does tell me somewhat they want to play Azir again. And they just don't want to risk the same thing happening in the late game or control mage in the mid lane, and they don't want to risk having to match the scaling of a Veigar. So they value that above getting or banning away to Lulu. We might as well see them do something completely different, and they just want to avoid what KOO can do in the late game on this champion, because they have made mistakes, Fnatic in the early game, which has allowed KOO Tigers to get to late game, which means this Veigar pick, even if shut down early on, will activate at some point during the game and become super, super powerful.
Now, Lulu has been played once by the KOO Tigers this tournament, by KOO, and it was a loss. We need to see how they handle themselves and what Fnatic will run into it. Currently, the hover is on the TF. We know that Kalista is still up and available, but Fnatic have not played that yet. Kennen's up too.
Kennen is up too. I mean, you can do a full global comp here. You have Rek'Sai already. Twisted Fate, you don't have to pick it now, though, the way I see it for Fnatic. Because if KOO Tigers wants to try and skirmish you early on with Smeb up in the top lane, you bring two, three, four teleports, and you say, hey, you're not alone now. It's not a 1v1 anymore.
But yeah. Fnatic just goes with the early Orianna pick, though, which, if you're going to pick Orianna, I like picking it in this context. However, coming into this series, the only two games Fnatic had lost had been Febiven on Orianna. It's not a surefire playmaker. Mm-hmm. It is more of a late-game champion, and it is good in the lane at least. So Fnatic is definitely keeping their options open, if more than anything here.
It's one of these small counter picks into a Lulu in the laning phase. You will win that as the Orianna. But it is a bit what we talked about, how by banning Veigar, it seemed like Fnatic want to try and get a scaling mage in the mid lane, just not want to deal with Veigar's scaling as well. So ban him away, so they might run a composition now, a wombo combo composition against his Lulu and say, okay, you can only ulti one guy. If we get two or three with our AoE comp, the Lulu ulti will do very little. But obviously you have to then execute it perfectly.
All right, we'll see if Febiven can make that work and how well Yellowstar is going to perform on this Thresh. First time here at Worlds 2015. Thresh has somewhat fallen by the wayside as a go-to support. We did see last week KT versus KOO. And we'll see what Yellow can do with it today. Lee Sin locked in for Hojin, formerly known as Lee, and Prey going to his Ashe once more.
This is actually the jungle pick I expected, not the Zac. In most of these games, Hojin did get some good late-game teamfights with the Zac, but this is much more his style. It's not a good matchup against the Rek'Sai, but it's probably better than Zac as far as early game matchup.
Oh, for sure.
Because Lee Sin is a good early-game champion. I really like those two picks from KOO. They're also forcing Fnatic into some difficult choices because the Ash Arrows can be game-changing.
Yeah, KOO Tigers is running with a lot of pick potential here. Lee Sin single out a guy, Ash Arrow single out a guy. Alistar is fantastic at diving again, catching out people. So KOO Tigers with a lot of pick potential on their side. So far, though, not running a whole lot of damage.
And a big change in style for Hojin. Both of his Zac games previously, the pre-6 ganks almost non-existent. Now, gonna have the option to surprise Fnatic. They will go blind pick Riven.
So, I want to see Lissandra soon. Someone has to play Lissandra top into like Fiora or Riven, but nobody's done it so far. Not sure Smeb needs to.
I think we're gonna have to wait for Marin to play it in the finals. It's one of his most played champions in solo queue, and both these guys are Riven players, or on Smeb's case, a Fiora player.
Smeb can just go Fiora and
doesn't
take the same
seem
matchup.
Like Fiora is in Huni's champion pool here. Could end up costing them a whole bunch. Or does Smeb go and play the same pick into Huni? So Huni played into Smeb.
Let's think back to game one. Because what happened in this matchup, it was very even early, but as soon as Huni got a bit of armor picked up for that Frozen Heart as the first item, there was no traits going on anymore. He could just push out the wave all the time and look for flanks. He didn't have to worry about the Riven trying to all in him. So Smeb is gonna do exactly the same. Again, it's a composition with so much pick potential coming in here. If Fnatic is mispositioned, that's an arrow in your face. Lee Sin kicks you back and smack.
And I think the Hecarim is a reliable counterpick to the Riven. It is a favorable matchup later on in the game, whereas the Fiora is still a skill matchup that Smeb won, but they're not necessarily taking risks here. Hojin on a comfortable champion. KOO had to do the Lulu denial. These are actually much different team compositions that we did see in game one, so maybe we see a completely unique game here.
And we got to see Fnatic take the best of both worlds. Rek'Sai first pick, so you have that early game jungler. I still think this is a lot more mixed compared to what we saw before. They have a control mage who can scale in the mid lane, and you have an early game jungler compared to before, where they were in a situation where they had to pick a Skarner because Rek'Sai and Elise were banned away. And they're like, okay, how do we get early pressure? Skarner? Nope, that's not going to work. So now they have a bit of everything.
Okay.
And we need to see how they make use of all of their different tools, because this could be the last game from a European team on European soil. Ladies and gentlemen of Brussels, Let your votes be known on Twitter and with your cheers. Will Fnatic be able to pick up any games at all in this best of five semi-final? Or will KOO show the Korean dominance and have our first ever all-Korean final at the World Championships? It's game three with Fnatic on the blue side, fighting to stay alive. And that hill has become incredibly challenging.
Fnatic has to win three games in a row, but with the closeness of the first two, it is a definite possibility. What we have to keep in mind, though, is if this game starts early for the KOO Tigers in a favorable fashion, if they get first blood, if they start up a couple thousand gold, I think the entire series is over. I do not think mentally a team can come back from that type of start after the agonizing way they were defeated in the first two matches.
Also not running double teleport on the side of Fnatic. FNC once again is going all in on this laning phase. Orianna does do really well into Lulu, so he's looking to once again push Koro into his own tower and open up for Reignover to be more aggressive, invade into the enemy jungle, take one-on-ones, 2v2s in there, use that Riven as well for extra damage in the early game. So Fnatic will have tools to play around the early game, but we know what happens late game when you're down a teleport.
Well, KOO Tigers have already shown that their quarterfinal form of falling behind and then bouncing back is something they can do comfortably. Their group stage form was significantly more impressive in the early game, securing a ton of kills and punishing both Pain and CLG. Let's see if Hojin with Prey and Smeb can again get that strong early and maybe snuff out any hope of Fnatic pulling the reverse sweep.
Yeah, I think absolutely with Lulu and Ashe, they can still have a decent late game plan, but this is more KOO Tigers composition that'll take some risks early. This is more of the group stage style of KOO, where maybe they feel comfortable enough to make plays. Just wait for the first time Fnatic groups and see if Prey lands the Ashe arrow that starts the cascade.
Prey is probably the best Ashe player in Korea. He was one of the first guys to really bring it out again during the playoffs and so on. He's very known for having fantastic hawk shots, and then also, of course, that arrow landing at the correct target. And KOO Tigers really looking a little more, they're gonna spike more in the mid game with what they're running here in this game.
Final, potentially final match of the series. Ebevin and Kuro going toe to toe. We are gonna see the head to head matchup up top as well. Huni and Smeb settling in. And both duos going toe. So we'll see what Huni can do. He ran the Hecarim first, but it's coming off way worse for wear. Smeb just throws Spirit of Dread and laughs in his face.
Yeah, and Hecarim also has Ignite, so he's up a Combat Summoner in this lane. You almost have to gank the Hecarim early, but if he's chunking the opponent laner like this, you can't do that either. Huni's hoping that he can bounce the wave off the turret here and then recall, but he's taken so much damage early, he's going to be in for a world of hurt.
Let's just remember Smeb is running Flask and three Potions. So the fact he's winning early trades so easily, is it going to make it even worse for Huni because he has no way now of sustaining himself. 3% life still on his Ornn's Blade is absolutely nothing for him.
He's really trying hard, but he knows once Smeb hit level 3, he can get the E up with Ignite. It would be enough to kill Huni out of lane. That's why he's really delaying this recall. Early laning phase goes heavily to Smeb top lane.
So Smeb with a soft counter pick already in a good position. We'll see how early he can get that armor secured. Reckless and Yellow, they're pushing heavily in the bottom lane.
So, this Riven pick for Huni will most likely just be because it's a comfort pick for him. I don't see Fnatic necessarily go and camp the lane. Because if you look at what they've done with the rest of their comp, you have a counter pick in mid that's going to push in to tower. Look where Fibrin is on the map now. Sivir against Ashe. Sivir can fast push the wave over and over, and Ashe cannot push it back. She can outtrade the Sivir, but that's very difficult to do when you have minions around you. So Fnatic have two lanes pushing on the bottom side of the map that will constantly push into tower. That's what Reignover is going to use to get into the jungle near that blue buff, take that control, and always chip away in these towers here for Fnatic. Play it fairly slow, honestly. You don't have to like go for a crazy dive. Just keep pushing in waves on the bottom side. Huni just has to stay alive on the top lane.
You look at the speed in which Reignover cleared that jungle. No hesitation, full clear, and sightstone. So more what we saw in the quarterfinals, where he had an average 6 minutes sightstone. This one's 4.5 minutes sightstone.
It's one of the things the analyst desk was saying they'd like to see a little bit more from Fnatic, the Sightstones. They're hoping for two TPs. We'll see if Reignover can make use of the vision provided. And Huni again, coming off worse for wear in that trade. Smeb just runs him down with the devastating charge and rampages.
You have to be so careful now because you're going Sightstone first on your Rek'Sai. against a jungler who's going to go warrior and charm. So Hojin will have some more early game power with his longsword. And if Rek'Sai takes a risky gank on topside, you know Hojin likes to sit up there and wait.
You mean like this?
Like this, that could end very quickly in two kills for Blue Tigers.
So weird to be having the Riven here. It's the danger of the blind pick, because now you have to play Riven into an unfavorable matchup. And that, Kobe loves to talk about it all the time. You have to gank for a Riven lane when you're on Riven's team or against Riven's team, because that's where the jungle attention is going to be going. And that actually plays into KOO right here. So Huni needs to play defensively on Riven, which almost always leads to a large CS discrepancy in Riven's, not in Riven's favor.
Yeah, the only thing we might see happen for Fnatic is if they keep Reynova on topside, maybe force Hojin to stay there so there's no jungle pressure on the two lanes pushing for Fnatic, and they just let Pepevan and Reckless do the job on their own while you try and, you know, bait attention on the top side. But we keep seeing these trades. Smeb is already gonna get some early armor. He's gonna get that Frozen Heart as his first item, and Huni doesn't really have that chance to all in.
No, not at all. 10 CS down already. Smeb still got that ignite and the sustain. Huni's gonna lose even more CS. So a miracle TP play is what they're looking for. Febivan throws down the shockwave almost as soon as he unlocks it. Just trying to bully KOO out. Got himself a 10 CS advantage. It's something, but it's not massive just yet.
So now with Reynover being around topside, getting two deep wards in to try and spot Hojin on in the red jungle here, which is very nice. It did mean once he maybe had a small chance to gank the bottom lane, he obviously wasn't nearby because he's been making work on the other side of the map. Frey and Gorilla are overextending at the moment. You have Lantern, you have Flash for Yellow Star. There's a lot of ways to set up this gank. And I like the fact he's now sneaking down towards this gank. He can even go over the wall with his tunnel, and then he goes the opposite side towards the mid lane.
It's pretty smart of Reynover, though. He knows he doesn't actually have the combat effectiveness with Sightstone right now, and he's successfully and safely gotten two wards deep within the jungle of KOO. So at the very least, he's stopping Hojin from having early jungle presence, or so he hopes. Yellowstar with a very poor face check.
Oh, he's in so much trouble. Flash and Exhaust are available. Yellowstar manages to sidestep the Sonic Wave. Teleport started, then cancelled by KOO. So they do get at least one of those summoners at the cost of their flash and heal.
Strange play from Yellowstar. I'm 100% sure they saw Hojin in the jungle with the wards just being placed from Reynover's side.
That was one of those things, well, if I check it in here, I am gonna lose. So I should check it just to make sure that's not the case.
Because even if there's nobody there, what was gonna happen? He would just walk up the river.
Yes. Very, very foolish play there, but he keeps his exhaust at least. I like the fact that he has exhaust, specifically against Hecarim.
But these small mistakes is exactly why KOO Tigers in the last two games have been able to always, even when it's really far behind, find a way back into the game. Because Fnatic would then make that little overextension or have that one bad call they made, and that's where KOO Tigers punish you every single time in the early
game. And it goes further than just that. In the quarterfinal matchup, KOO just kept showing ways. They knew how to defend. They knew how to play on the back foot. And they've done that in their own region during the course of the summer split. I mean, this is the team that is looking the most likely to advance on to the championship finals. And every single time they show up, they find new ways to impress and new ways to look good on the Rift.
Although Pepevin does have that 21 CS advantage on KOO, KOO, even with the catch, is still losing this early game by 400 gold, even with the counterpick in the top lane. So there are definite things not going well for KOO Tigers. Yet, as you say, Quickshot, they consistently find ways to win.
I still like this from Reynover, how he goes up not to gank, but just to place a ward. Now he finds Hojin as well.
He's gonna look for the knockup. Huni actually flashes over the wall. Dragon's Rage will buy some time. Reynover's holding on to his flash. Huni pulled the trigger very early. Look at the river. KOO has got support. Reynover and Huni, they've gone too far. Onslaught of Shadows sends them against the wall. Smeb is looking for Huni, looking for First Blood. Febivan does have Shockwave, but will not use it. Flash is available in KOO Tigers. They secure the first kill.
Great roam by Gorilla to be there, and that's ultimately what salvaged the kill at the end. But honestly, there were so many small misplays by Fnatic in the approach of that gank. First off, Reynover didn't have to jump over the wall early because Hojin was going to walk around that bend, and then he could have followed with his tunnel. Secondly, he unburrowed early and didn't chain the CC with Huni, but with the Alistar roam up in the top lane, Fnatic at least cross maps with the turret.
Yeah, that's what I like about the play here for Fnatic, is the fact that either it's 3v3 and it's even because they forced Hojin away, or if another guy joins, being an AD carry support or whatever, you take the bot tower, because again, remember what Fnatic has done for the first 10 minutes, constantly push the bot lane and the mid lane and chip away on the towers.
The idea of the play was great. Reignover preempted the Lee Sin invade. The execution of the play was extremely lackluster, and KOO out-executed once again. That's basically how KOO has been winning these games. I think strategically, Fnatic has had a lot of superior calls, but KOO has just been playing better in the moment again and again.
Let's see if Reckless can outplay Gorilla. Spell shields the headbutt, and Gorilla not going to be quick enough on that pulverize, but gets the summoner spell, and that means Reignover, Huni, and Reckless, or even Yellow, are flashless for the next few minutes.
In order for Reckless now to move further in this game, he's already taking his own bot lane tower. There's no value in him just constantly pushing the bot lane, really, at the moment. So he really wants to push out this wave and then swap the top lane and 2v1 the Hecarim. But because he just lost the flash, it becomes so much harder for him to do. And here's a dive.
Yellow Star's in trouble. He's been caught by the Crystal Arrow. The TP is going to bring some more play from KOO. They get themselves a second kill. And maybe even the tower if they stick around for this next wave.
Now that was a good play by KOO. That's exactly what they want to do in that situation. They burned the early summoner spell by Reckless. They made it even more dangerous for Yellowstar to stay under, and they abused their double teleport advantage.
Exactly. That's where, again, Fnatic can get punished for not running a teleport in the mid lane. Had Febron had TP ready, had he had the summoner at all, right here he would just have TP'd instant down to this bot lane tower, and this dive would never even have started. KOO Tigers are just saying, we can be four members against three. We have an Alistar to dive. Easy, let's go for it, and that's a kill.
And despite being down 30 CS in the mid lane, with KOO's kill and assist, he's even on gold with Febivin. So he's using that teleport to keep himself very, very relevant.
I think you are in a winning lane matchup without the offensive summoner on the side of Fnatic. So when we even heard Yerzo Smith say, oh, let's see what happens top.
All right, let's throw everything and the sink at Smith. He's already chunked Huni down. The flay comes out. All sorts of shadows.
Man.
Smith's got one and he's not. Done. He's looking for Yellowstar and Reignover. Reignover unburrows the rest of KOO coming from the jungle. And ladies and gentlemen, if Huni wasn't tilted already, that may be the play. That does it.
Smeb is putting his stamp on this series like he did in the quarterfinals as well. 1v3, and he turns it around. He was already in a winning matchup. He already had stacked armor, yet they gank him with double physical damage and expect it to go well. That was a poor call by Fnatic, and we were wondering what would happen if they started behind in this game. How desperate would they become already being down 2-0? That was one of the worst decisions Fnatic has made all series.
Gonna cost them the top tower. Reckless was trying to shove in middle, but unable to secure the mid turret. All of a sudden, Fnatic are now 2,000 gold down, 3 kills down, an extra tower down, and the pressure continues to mount.
He had the right plan in the start. Reignover wouldn't gank, he would just get over the sidestone, place deep wards, make sure Riven could farm, make sure your laners were safe so they could keep pushing the waves. Play, it's slow. You even have that combat summoner in mid lane, so you're supposed to win it. Riven is ahead in farm, so again, just wait it out. Take these towers. Instead, Fnatic, after giving up one kill, instantly says, okay, let's go for another fight. Now suddenly we need to do something, otherwise we're gonna fall behind. And that's where KOO Tigers can punish him completely.
Oh, you've got to flash sideways, Febivin. He doesn't get away from the arrow. And an easy pickup for KOO. Now they've even got uncontested time towards this middle lane.
You gotta hand it to KOO Tigers, though. They are absolutely recognizing where Fnatic is at, and they are going for the aggressive plays. Prey with Ash does this against everybody. Beautiful arrow from right outside of fog, flashes backwards instead of sideways. I don't think that's a play Febivin makes in game one, but based on the circumstances of this match, he flashes straight backwards, KOO converts, gets their fourth kill.
Making it just look so, so easy. The enchanted arrow from Prey, that library card continues to get stamped for Fnatic. And KOO are just now starting to strangle the life out of Fnatic. They do have wave clear in Orion and Sivir, so there is some comeback mechanics, but they cannot afford to keep falling prey to prey as those Ash arrows get flung out.
And again, they don't have a teleport. So KOO Tigers can say, okay, we're just gonna 1-3-1, push in every single lane. Whenever Fnatic sends someone to the bottom side to defend like they're doing now, they get
right in a gorilla.
All of a sudden, Reckless is delivered into the hands of Kuro, but there's no damage to follow it up. Ku may have bitten off a little more than they can chew. Bray's in trouble. He gets away from the Wind Slash as the teleport's coming in here for Smith. He's now landed. Onslaught of Shadows is available. Hooney's on the front line. Not even needed. Smith throws the Onslaught towards the tower.
Into the tower.
And Hooney's left for dead. Shockwave connects on Bray, but doesn't find a kill. Top laners are down, and Fnatic are able to at least go even after an over-aggressive play from Ku.
This was almost the best Fnatic could hope for. We saw it. Fevin was down on bottom lane to clear the wave that was pushed in by Koro, so Ku Tiger said, okay, now we have a numbers advantage. We can engage in the mid lane. We're still only 15 minutes in, though. So diving between two towers, so now to be a little bit more than what the Ku Tigers could do. But in the end, it's still one for one.
I think Kutagris is trying to push the tempo a little bit with their Warrior Lee Sin, especially at this stage in the game, which is why you're seeing such an aggressive roam from Gorilla and the Lulu down already. They actually used the Lulu ultimate very early. Gorilla to overtank that turret, but then immediately have to turn on the retreat because Prey actually took turret aggro. So not a coordinated play, a rarity from Ku so far in this series. Snap teleports in defensively, and I actually like the heal from Reckless while the Onslaught of Shadows comes out to position and not get knocked backwards. I think that was very critical.
The end though, Smep gets pulled into tower, goes down, but we're gonna see Ku Tigers try and do this again. Look at Lulu on the bottom side of the map. Fnatic is pinging and saying, okay, this might be our chance to rush in mid tower. To force at least the teleport from Koro. That's the best you can hope for if you are Fnatic. Force the TP, then back away, but then do it again in 2 minutes' time when Ku Tigers cannot put up this 1-3-1 pressure. So Fnatic want to force a teleport right now to get that summoner away. But Ku Tigers, they know it. They're ready to fight.
Oh, Gorilla's gone in and found three. The arrow connects onto Reckless and he's dead. He gets kicked backwards. Gorilla's the one with the kill credit. We just see Hooney take the lantern to safety. Tower will give Fnatic some breathing room. But Prey again finding the Enchanted Crystal Arrow. Reckless had flash. Smith may a little bit out of position. Hooney and Yellowstar trying to jump him down, but Gorilla comes forward. The Shockwave finds four. There's simply not enough ability power. Yellowstar and Rainover, like lambs to the slaughter, they throw themselves at the wall and come away wanting.
Yeah, trading a Thresh kill for an unnamed kill on the enemy side is not a good idea. Yellowstar really with a bit of a desperation play here, and I think this is another one. Fnatic desperately trying to turn this game around. Rainover's now in enemy territory without much backup.
Oh, he does have at least some protects and dissonances from Febivant. And that now puts Fnatic even further behind. 3,000 gold. Ku Tigers. They're showing up.
Yeah, they really are. Especially in this game where they're making the Ashe plays work. This is why Ashe was banned against them so many times earlier on.
So we get once again this trade between them, but the only positive thing really for Fnatic with this fight, even though they're losing all these members and it's obviously not a great play, is now they have a bit of time, but there's only one teleport on the side of Ku Tigers. This is your opening if you are Fnatic to get back into this game. You need that mid tower down. You need to get a team fight around a dragon and you need to win that team fight. If that doesn't happen, Ku Tigers is going to keep doing this for another 10 minutes and they're going to keep getting more and more kills.
I'm looking at the items though, and Fnatic just isn't there. Every powerful item that they need to complete, Death Cap on Orianna, anything on Hooney, Infinity Edge on Reckless,
yeah.
Ku is ahead of them in every single aspect
you
there.
You just don't
they
have a choice.
They cannot 5v5 unless they get a pick early, but Ku is the team getting the picks. Fnatic actually just needs to stall this one out and give away dragons.
The thing is, by stalling it out for Fnatic, you just put yourself in a situation where you will have to spread out on the map, wave clear in a side lane, and then five members from Ku Tigers will dive you in the mid or in the top lane, and they will get their kill or start setting up the Baron. So you just put yourself in a situation now where there is no good play. And that's the worst situation you could be in as a team in League of Legends, because normally you always have, okay, there's one good play, one okay play, and there's a few bad plays. Obviously, we're trying to aim for the good one. Now you're in a situation where everything is bad, 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 maybe okay at the very, very best. And you need to outplay Ku Tigers then.
We have to give so much credit to Ku Tigers. They were coming in, heralded by many as one of the weaker Korean teams, but Hojin finds a death sentence and is the support of Gorilla on the hunt is coming out. Mimi has arrived from the back line. Dragon's Rage finds four Asharo onto Febivin as well. Gorilla's still running interference. Reckless has got a kill onto Hojin and Gorilla's unbreakable will is quite early. So the bad plays have resulted in a net plus one kill. Defensive flay to get rid of Smeb. Hooney's trampled underneath the weight of that power pony. Reckless is in trouble. The shockwave's already been pulled. And Fnatic's last chance, last ditch effort is being strangled away. Who take four? The cost of two.
You can see what Fnatic is trying to do. Again, they're simply saying we have to just try and go for some insanely risky plays.
Fnatic continues to be here, and because of the item differentials in this team,
get punished for it. Koo Tigers, 21 minutes in, is 5,000 gold ahead. And this is the team who's been playing normally really well in the late game.
Yep.
Did make some mistakes in the last game though, where Fnatic almost managed to get back. Wasn't enough in the end.
Yeah, this is a team who has been down this amount of gold earlier in the game and still beaten Fnatic.
And I asked the question at the beginning of the day, if Fnatic get the lead that KT had from the quarterfinal, will Fnatic close it out?
I said yes back then. I definitely expected more from Fnatic when it came to their shot calling, how to snowball the games.
But all credit to KOO for again punishing when the mistake. Presented playing so safe they didn't provide more opportunities for the lead to extend. This is a team that is. You can question some of their calls, but you cannot question their ability to find ways back into the game. They wiggle out of every chokehold they're put into.
Very creative teamwork. You can tell KOO Tigers, really Gorilla picked the team that he wanted to play with. A lot of old members from Najin.
The B team at the beginning of the year,
a lot of players,
right?
That had been rejected by other organizations, and they are not even just one game away from the final, a couple fights away from the final.
Wow, Febby. It's already dead. Shockwave didn't even get used. Wild growth on that frontline Gorilla. Unbreakable will reducing any damage he could take. And KOO just say we'll have that and brute force their way into the. Mid in a turret.
It's the same situation again for KOO Tigers. They push in at least two lanes, so they have one guy from Fnatic defending. This time it was Hooney with no teleport, and they know, okay, he's gonna catch the wave of tier 2 tower. We walk straight through Fnatic's jungle, and we just dive them five members. We have so much engage. Hecarim, Alistar, Ashe, Lee Sin, like almost all the champions can start the fight for KOO Tigers and get that one pick, and they even spike in this mid game.
Hooney's in trouble. The onslaught will throw Smeb far enough to get the kill credit. Reckless is now exhausted. Yellowstar's trying to run interference. There's no box available for zoning. It's a double kill for Smeb, and Kuro gets his third. Fnatic were dancing around the Baron Pit, and KOO take their lives.
The mid game power spike of Hecarim Lulu. There is really no speed equivalent to that combo when you're trying to run away. So even though Reckless was far from the origin point of that battle, he ends up catching the bad end of it.
Rainover and Febivin standing against KOO. They're in the Baron Pit and
pretty
low.
Good shockwave opportunity.
The shockwave is available, but the headbutt will knock Rainover away. Shockwave gets damaged, but nothing more. And KOO Tigers have the tools they need to finish this game out, to clean sweep Fnatic.
Definitely didn't expect that coming into this series. We knew KOO Tigers were great.
This was always going to be the most contested series we've seen.
We all looked at Fnatic.
It could have gone either way.
As the Western hope, basically, for getting into the final with Origin facing SK Telecom. Nobody expected a whole lot from that match. But this one here, it's been surprising how well KOO Tigers been able to play when behind. Even when ahead outside of those 5 minutes in game 2, and we just gotta give it to them. They really deserve to be so far ahead in this game and already be up 2-0.
What a year for KOO Tigers. Not only were they... Oi! Asher also comes in. Hero's just gonna keep trying to run down Huni. Put together as someone of the B team, Reckless, on the hunt. He does not want to get caught out. Smith still got that onslaught.
Fnatic just has to concede so much right now. KOO has been able to play this game, specifically the 1-4, with giant gold deficits. So with a mid-game team composition in the mid-game, with a 10,000 gold lead, they are making it look easy.
And really, this game has just been all about KOO Tigers. Picks and bans, something that it feels KOO have had their finger on the button all series long. Hell, all tournament long, really, for most of the games. And just showing up on the big stage.
And now we just need KOO to take this wave in the mid lane with the Baron buff. Not sure why he didn't want it before. Fnatic keep looking for that one opening where you catch a guy slightly out of position. But even getting that one kill now won't really result in anything for Fnatic. Smeb, he doesn't care about Huni down here at all.
Not at all. Three level difference. The Wild Growth comes up. Huni's gonna get shut down. Gorilla finds two with the Pulverize, and despite the decent shockwave, it will not matter. Reckless is on the retreat. Febivin's got no mana, and Smeb just prances into his face. Takes another inhibitor away from Fnatic. 11,000 gold lead. That's gonna grow even more as these minions funnel through. Inhibitor number two is going to fall. And KOO Tigers can play this one safe. Not make the same shenanigans that we saw from the previous game. Three inhibitors down. Almost giving Fnatic an opportunity back into the game.
And I hate to say it, but how similar is this series to the one we saw yesterday? As far as the nature of the games playing out. Origin played SKT really close in game one.
They're gonna try now, Fnatic.
Well, Rainover's arrived. Huni teleported to the tunnel and gonna try look for a kill. Gonna hold on to his ultimate in that wind slash. Hojin finds the Krux. He even makes it out alive at the investment of TP, Void Rush, even on the hunt, I believe.
And then aside from the big mistakes that KOO made at the end of game two, that was a more one-sided affair. And then game three has just been an absolute slaughter. KOO comes in with some different picks, more of their comfort, you would say, with Hojin's Lee Sin. And this game isn't even looking close.
I think KOO Tigers, what they do so well, is they make so many of these low-risk plays. They're very consistent in the way they play it. They don't go for that all-in tower dive that completely backfire very, very often. Even when they had a bad play in the mid lane, it's because they were so far ahead already and they end up just trading one for one. So very rarely do you see them completely mess it up. Where Fnatic, their playstyle is a lot more high risk, high reward. They will go for these aggressive plays, but against a team who's ready for it, it can backfire very easily. And that's what we have seen in this series.
Well, Death Sentence finds Smith. But Yellow Stars just booted away. Shockwave laying available in the middle of the lane. Prey not going to step close enough. The Super is now inside the base of Fnatic. Huni to play with time and play with the Winions. That's all they need. Huni's trying to deal with him on the bottom lane.
Yep, two inhibitors down. This time Fnatic doesn't have an Azir, who's much better at clearing multiple waves of Super. So even these two waves of Super minions give KOO a big win on the takedown inhibitor three or the game.
Gorilla's found Reckless and Smith once more. Reckless gets feared towards his Nexus. Febivin's on the retreat, waits for Exhaust to tag before throws down the Shockwave. Huni wants to try clean up, but the Dragon's Rage will send the team away. It is a double kill for Fnatic. They're defending, but it's very little. It's very late, and I don't think it's going to matter.
Rainover jumped a mile behind the rest of the team while they were trying to trace out. Now he's in trouble. They lose the inhibitor, but they do pick up some kills.
Might be able to get Prey.
Let's take a look.
It's Trevor.
Prey Seeker
doesn't want to be here. Smip can easily pick this kill up. They're going to go one for one. This is the best friend battle, ladies and gentlemen. Rainover and Smip throws up the flare, but it is Smip that will have the last laugh.
As in life, your best friend just runs away from you.
Smeb probably says only players who can make it to finals get to fight one. And walks away from Huni.
Oh, I like that.
And rain over.
Well, 10,000 gold down, doubles to... Super minions in every single lane. just one more time of this last-ditch effort here from Fnatic.
Gorilla makes a pretty nice initiation. I honestly think there's a pretty big overreach by Ku Tiger, so they didn't even finish killing the inhibitor because they're splitting their damage so heavily when they make this hit.
Yeah, whenever we say they're making all these low-risk plays and so on, and they get really far ahead in the game, they go for these fights. We're like, oh, okay, they just gave them a few kills.
SK Telecom.
And you can't help but be happy for the KOO Tigers. Especially Gorilla, who has done so much this year to make this team happen, to coax this team through the season. Finalist of the LCK in the spring. Qualified on championship points and has never really been given their fair shot as a top team. Maybe for a small amount of time in the spring, people were saying it. Now they have the chance to definitively be the best team in the world if they can take down SKT.
Very few people look at some of these players on this lineup and really praise them, but we get to see what they can do here. Gorilla, fantastic support. Smeb in the top lane going crazy every single game. Obviously, when there's a winner, there is a loser as well.
Crushing defeat for Fnatic.
What great play from KOO. All told, every time they're discounted or underestimated, they show up and surprise absolutely everybody.
But it's been such a weird year for the KOO Tigers. They start out in the spring split by winning everything, being number one.
It's also been a huge year for Fnatic, coming all the way to the semifinals, and the crowd is showing their appreciation.
The final vote has landed, and it was a European eulogy as both EU squads drop at the semi-final stage.
I still think that both the EU teams and EU fans can be very proud.
They put up
this tournament
more of a fight than many were expecting at times, but mistakes that we did not see from the Korean squads of KOO Tigers and SKT is a very large part of why they won those series.
So often been the story. The Western teams trying, having some great plays in there, having some good players who can challenge them. But then, as a team, the consistency kind of lacks when it comes to the calls, and that's where it can go wrong against these Korean teams who really will punish you. And that's what we see.